We'll call to order the Subcommittee on Communications and Technology. And I want to welcome everyone here today and wish a very good morning to Chairman Wheeler and Commissioner Pye. Delighted to have you back before the Subcommittee again this year. We appreciate the work you're doing at the FCC and look forward to your testimony and our opportunities to pursue some issues. At the risk of sounding a bit like a broken record, however, I continue to be concerned with the Commission's failure to adhere to sound regulatory process. For the nearly 5 years that I've had the opportunity to chair this subcommittee, as you all know, I've consistently pushed to make the FCC a better, more transparent agency. And yet it seems like the chasm between commissioners deepens over time. When the committee considered process reform legislation a few months ago, I had hoped we had reached the bottom of that well, that the commission would begin to find its way back to the collegiality and honest policy debates and compromises that have characterized it since 1934. Unfortunately, that appears not to be the case. And if Commissioner Pye's testimony is any indications, things might actually be getting worse at the commission. And that's disappointing, to say the least. With all that's going on at the Commission and in the world of communications, we have much ground to cover in today's hearing, which likely will necessitate a second round of questioning. To get things started, let me highlight five areas of policy concern that I and some other members of this committee have. First, the auction. For a successful auction, we all know that the sellers and buyers need to fully understand and support the rules. Yet when it comes to the band plan, questions and uncertainty still abound. Layered on top is growing concern regarding how the repack will work, including as it relates to the future of low-power television stations and translators. Now, it was never our intent that these diverse voices in the marketplace would get fully silenced. And then there are the issues of potential interference, which have come up, which, as we all know, when mishandled, can doom an auction, as has occurred in the past. Second, the FCC's action on the designated entity issue raises some concerns for many of us. While the FCC majority claims that its changes will strengthen the integrity of the program, a goal we all share, sadly, I'm afraid they simply replace one set of rules that were gamed with a new set yet to be gamed. The Commission's new rules remove the obligation to provide facilities-based service and permit leasing of 100% of the spectrum purchased. Now, that sets the stage for sophisticated spectrum arbitragers financed by taxpayer dollars to participate in the next spectrum auction, bringing nothing to the competitive market. The chairman's advocacy for this outcome is puzzling, given the assurances that the changes would protect the program from quote-unquote slick lawyers taking advantage of loopholes in the program to unjustly enrich their sophisticated clientele. Third, Telephone Consumer Protection Act. My colleague from New Mexico and I have had serious bipartisan discussions about the approach the FCC has taken as it relates to the fundamental nature of democracy in America and practical communications in a wireless age. Beyond that, members of this subcommittee are just beginning to hear from adversely affected users about the disruption this new ruling will have on a variety of companies and the consumers they try to serve. Fourth, expansion of the Lifeline program. All one has to do is read today's story in Politico regarding the problems over at the Department of Agriculture's Rural Utility Service to understand why it's so essential before any agency moves to spend money, it should have tight control and a budget. Unfortunately for ratepayers, in a party-line vote, the FCC decided to rush forward to expand the Lifeline program into broadband with little reform and no limit on the spending. Fifth, amid the swirl of controversy that continues to surround the actions the Commission takes, let us not lose sight of what is not getting done. For example, the AM revitalization proceeding has been described by some as grinding to a halt, despite the Chairman's assurances to this subcommittee. The quadrennial review of the limitations on ownership of broadcast properties continues to languish in open violation of the Commission's legal obligation. Let me close with this. Each member of the Commission is very bright, talented, and clearly passionate. And yet, as evidenced by recent public comments of Commissioner O'Reilly and the testimony today of Commissioner Pye, it's clear that they believe the process at the FCC too often fails to include them in a meaningful and substantive way. And we hear similar complaints from stakeholders who feel ignored or shut out altogether. This is neither necessary nor helpful as the Commission and all of us in Congress try to work through the complicated issues in today's rapidly evolving communications world. And on a final note, on the good news side of things, at least if you have the background I have, I'm pleased to note that AT&T today announced that they are reached an agreement to allow FM chips in cell phones, making at least the second carrier to do so, and we hope that other carriers will follow suit. With that, I have used up my time and turn to the gentlelady from California.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and good morning, Chairman Wheeler, Commissioner Pai. Welcome back to the committee. We're happy to see you, and we, as I said, we welcome you back. Today's hearing marks the chairman's third appearance before our subcommittee in just over 4 months. In fact, the Congressional Research Service tells me that the chairman's 8 appearances before Congress this year marks a new record. So congratulations, Mr. Chairman. Put that one up on your wall. In the past 14 years, no FCC chair has testified more times before Congress in a single calendar year. And of course, we're only in the 7th month of 2015. It is our subcommittee's responsibility to conduct robust oversight, and in so doing, we should hear regularly from the chairman and his fellow commissioners. Responsible oversight includes a recognition that the FCC, and I think that we should be doing this. I mean, there are many things to raise that are legitimate, at least in the minds of those that that raise them. But we should include a recognition that the FCC has undertaken an unprecedented series of steps to promote competition, enhance public safety, and ensure that consumers are protected against deceptive or misleading billing practices. Here are a few highlights of the Commission's work over the past year. Modernize the E-rate program to increase the presence of Wi-Fi in classrooms and bolster higher capacity internet connections to the anchor institutions in our communities across the country, our schools and our libraries. Raised a record $44.9 billion, with a B, dollars from the AWS3 auction. Repealed the outdated and anti-consumer sports blackout rules, which for 40 years, prevented fans from watching games on television when they were not sold out. I think there are a lot of people in the country that are really thrilled about that. Launched a new consumer help center to streamline the complaint process and improve how consumers interact with the FCC. And at this point, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to ask unanimous consent to place into the record a really terrific article from Forbes entitled How the FCC Saved Me $1,800. If you haven't read it, everyone should. So I ask
without objection.
Thank you. Freed up 150 megahertz of spectrum in the 3.5 gigahertz band for mobile broadband. Established indoor location accuracy rules for wireless calls made to 911. That could be a life-saving step right there. Adopted Brightline rules that prevent broadband providers from engaging in blocking, throttling, and paid prioritization. Levied a $100 million fine against a major telecommunications provider for misleading consumers about their unlimited data plans. Preempted state laws in Tennessee and North Carolina that prevented local communities from deploying broadband, which they want to do across the country. All of this and more in just 1 year. And there's much more ahead as the FCC prepares to undertake the world's first voluntary incentive auction and a technology transition to an all-IP world that preserves the core values of competition, public safety, and consumer protection. So I thank both the chairman and the commissioner for your continuing commitment to a modern telecommunications marketplace, and I yield the remainder of my time to the gentleman from Vermont, Mr. Welch.
Thank you very much. Welcome, Chairman Wheeler and Commissioner Pai. Really appreciate the work that you're doing. Just a couple of points. I'm very encouraged by the tech transitions progress that you've been making. That is going to be very helpful to many more businesses that need efficiencies, and it's going to be helpful to consumers. I hope you don't stop there. One of my main concerns, I know concern of many of us, is to have competition as much as possible in this area. We really do believe that leads to innovation and better prices for the consumers. So the special access issues continue to be of top concern to me. And then finally, I'd like to just remind you of the bipartisan rural working group that Mr. Latta and I have set up, because there's so many of us, even if we represent urban areas, that have rural districts that have special problems and oftentimes aren't the big markets. So we want to continue to work with the entire commission to try to make certain that the rural service is there and will be there and will be the highest quality. Thank you very much, and I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman yields back. Gentlelady yields back. Chair recognizes gentlelady from Tennessee, Ms. Blackburn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to welcome you both. We appreciate that you are here. I will say I disagree with my colleague from California as she talked about Tennessee. We saw that as stepping on states' rights, Mr. Chairman, and you know that you and I disagree on that. I am pleased that you all are here. I know you all saw the CTIA report last week, and I'm sure you've read the op-ed in today's paper by each of your predecessors, Mr. Jenikowski and Mr. McDowell. Getting spectrum to the marketplace is where we need to have our focus. And rather than getting off into all these tangential issues, your focus should be the core of your mission, which is dealing with spectrum deployment and usage. And when you look at the expected increase in the wireless arena, it draws more attention to this. You know, I was thinking as I was preparing for this hearing, when you go back and look at the industrial revolutions that we have had in this country, looking at the agricultural and the industrial mechanization revolutions, when you look at technology, information, we are almost at a point of being able to say there is this wireless revolution that is going on, because business transactions, health care, so many things are going to depend on the spectrum. And we want to make certain that you are focused on this. So we welcome you. We know that we have to be diligent in this. We look at what South Korea is already talking about doing, South Korea and Japan and the 5G and recapturing the momentum that at one point they had. And we don't want them to be the world leader. We want to be the world leader, and we've got to have you work with us on this. At this time, I yield the balance of my time to Mr. Latta.
Well, thank you very much, and I thank the gentlelady for yielding. And I want to thank Chairman Wheeler and Commissioner Pai for being with us again. It's great to see you both, and look forward to your statements and also to our questions today. The communications and technology industry is a very productive and dynamic sector of our economy. This is largely due to bright, innovative minds, and in part because this industry has been lightly regulated, with the ability to grow and evolve to the demands of the consumers. Therefore, we cannot afford to overlook the significance of the regulatory policies and how the FCC's decisions impact the industry's success. This is why I'm concerned with many of the actions and proposals emerging the FCC and the general lack of transparency, efficiency, and accountability at the agency. I hope today's hearing will provide us with an opportunity to discuss in more detail the Commission's policies, decisions, and processes. And I thank the General Lady for yielding. I yield back.
Yield back my time.
General Lady yields back. Chair recognizes gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Plone, for five.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to Chairman Wheeler and Commissioner Pai for coming back here today. I know it's been a busy few months since you last testified before the subcommittee, and I appreciate your willingness to come and give us an update. I'm particularly grateful for this opportunity to hear from Chairman Wheeler about how he's addressing the priorities of the Democratic members of this subcommittee, many of which are shared by our Republican colleagues. Our members are champions for improving universal access to broadband in the many underserved rural areas of our country. They've also been tireless advocates for the rights of residents of our vast tribal lands, and too often those living on tribal lands are unfairly left on the wrong side of the digital divide. I hope to hear how the FCC can help our efforts to improve deployment to these areas where the economics alone are not enough. Our members have also been devoted to improving public safety communications. This is especially meaningful for those of us whose districts were impacted by disasters like Hurricane Sandy. We believe that everyone should be able to call for help in an emergency, and I hope we hear more about what the Commission is doing to make our vision into a reality. Our members also share Chairman Wheeler's commitment to competition. That's why we led the charge to overhaul the FCC's designated entity program. Under the new rules that the FCC recently adopted, the program encourages robust participation from bona fide small businesses while allowing innovative business models more in line with today's dynamic wireless market. And we've also stood with our ranking member Eshoo in her battle to free up more spectrum for unlicensed use. These airwaves can lower barriers to entry and allow for more vigorous competition. And finally, I hope to learn more about what the Commission can do to support our work to protect consumers. For instance, I know several members of the subcommittee have been focused on the FCC's recent actions to address robocalls. We all agree that more needs to be done to crack down on unwanted commercial calls, and I hope to hear what the Commission can do to address the issues our members have raised. I'd like to yield 1 minute each of the time, well, I guess a minute and a half to Mr. Doyle and then a minute and a half to Ms. Matsui.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pallone, for yielding. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for holding this hearing, and to Commissioner Wheeler and Commissioner Pye, thank you both for being here today. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to recognize the accomplishments of the Commission and of this chairman. Since Tom Wheeler took over as chairman, the FCC has done much to advance our nation's telecommunications agenda, from establishing the FCC's open internet order to keeping the incentive action on track, updating the Lifeline program for the internet age, and meting out steep fines to telecommunication companies that abuse consumers. I also want to commend the chairman for advancing a pro-competitive agenda, both in wireline and wireless service. The Commission's upcoming vote on tech transitions, its action on special access, and the establishment of the spectrum reserve in the incentive auction are all important steps towards preserving and promoting competition. Mr. Chairman, keep up the good work. Thank you, and I'll yield to our colleague, Ms. Matsui.
Thank you very much for yielding to me. Welcome back, Chairman Wheeler and Commissioner Pye. It's great to see you again. I know you have a busy agenda, and I want to briefly highlight two priorities that I know we're all interested in. The first is making more spectrum available. Spectrum is our nation's invisible infrastructure of the 21st century. It's critical to keep our wireless economy growing. We need to talk about how to put more spectrum into the pipeline so we can continue to meet the demand. Congressman Guthrie and I have a bipartisan bill to create new incentives for federal users. We need to continue to explore these solutions. The second is making broadband access more affordable. Millions of Americans are still on the wrong side of the digital divide. The Lifeline program can and should help these Americans get and stay connected. I know the FCC has started work on these very important reforms, but we need to finish the job. I look forward to working with the whole commission as we talk about these matters and hopefully make progress on this, and I yield back the balance of my time. Thank you.
Gentlelady yields back. The gentleman yields back. And I think all time has now expired. So now we'll go to our two distinguished witnesses, Chairman of the Federal Communications Commission. Mr. Wheeler, we're delighted to have you back. Apparently, we were really delighted because we have you a lot, and that's a good thing. And so we welcome you and Commissioner Pye. But Mr. Wheeler, why don't you go ahead and lead off? Yeah, it's a modern technology thing.
I'm tempted to make some comment about being the national champion of appearances before, but I wouldn't want
we could arrange that.
I wouldn't want to go down that that route. But in the 10 weeks, in all seriousness, in the 10 weeks since I was last before this committee, there's been a lot happening, and I look forward to discussing it with you today. We've made significant progress to begin the incentive auction on March 29th, 8 months from tomorrow. So there's a lot of pressure on here. We've continued to grapple with the tech transitions issues that are raised by the movement from analog to IP networks. And we've approved one merger with conditions, another was withdrawn, and a new one was added. And then, of course, on top of that, the appeals court stayed or denied the request for a stay for the open internet rules. But one issue, which frankly caught me by surprise, was that which was raised by a letter signed by every member of this subcommittee having to do with local number portability. And I wanted to report directly to you on that. Our rules require that local number portability be ubiquitous. But it looks as though the manner in which the industry has set up the system does not fulfill that requirement. And I appreciate this committee bringing this to our attention. Implementation of the rule apparently requires that a mobile carrier have a presence in the home market of the ported phone number before the transition can occur. And this is something, of course, that's not possible for smaller regional carriers. So the effect of this is that if I were to move from Washington to a market served by a carrier not in Washington and to choose that carrier in a competitive choice process, I couldn't port my number. That's contrary to our rules, and I've asked that it be fixed. Yesterday, I wrote the four major carriers, as well as their trade associations, asking that they identify a solution and report back within 60 days. I believe the carriers are in the best position to fix this, and I look forward to their response. But I do want to say to this committee, after raising this issue in unanimity, that if this approach doesn't fix it with dispatch, we'll have to find other approaches that do. But I really appreciate the way that this committee called that to our attention, because we had not seen that previously. On another matter frequently raised by the committee, I'm pleased to report that the FCC has completed an exchange of letters with the Telecommunications Agency of Mexico, IFT, to harmonize TV and wireless spectrum on both sides of the border. Mexico is in the midst of its DTV transition, and we, as you know, are heading into an incentive auction and relocation of broadcast and mobile licenses. Where on the spectrum Mexico places its DTV licenses could therefore affect us and our U.S. licenses, and where we place our licenses could affect them. But thanks to the hard work of the International Bureau and the Spectrum Auction Task Force and the good faith negotiations of the Mexican IFT, this major hurdle has been vaulted. And I want to especially thank my counterpart in Mexico, Chairman Contreras Saldivar, and his commissioners for their leadership on this matter. To the north, we have been making similarly productive progress with our friends, the Canadians. I believe that once we have a decision next week on incentive auction procedures, that we'll be able to conclude that coordination as well. And finally, we've had frequent discussions with this committee about the open internet rule. Now that the D.C. Circuit has put it on an expedited track for judicial review, we're only 6 months or so away from that ruling, which I know we all have been waiting for. So thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member. I look forward to discussing these and any other issues you may want to raise.
Thank you, Chairman. Appreciate the update. We'll now go to Commissioner Pye. We're delighted to have you before the subcommittee again, and please go ahead with your testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman Walden, Ranking Member Eshoo, members of the subcommittee, thank you for inviting me to testify. This hearing comes at a critical time. The FCC is making judgments that will shape the communications landscape for years to come. I'll start with the broadcast incentive auction. The FCC is empowered to conduct this auction because of your bipartisan efforts. It's therefore disappointing that this proceeding has been run in a partisan manner. Time and again, Commissioner Mike O'Reilly and I have offered common sense ideas for improving auction rules and procedures. Often, we receive no response at all. When we do receive a response, it's almost always no. Fortunately, it isn't too late to change course. Broadcasters, wireless carriers, and unlicensed advocates all agree that the Commission's current ban plan is seriously flawed. I stand ready to work with these stakeholders and my fellow commissioners to do what Congress did when it passed the landmark incentive auction legislation: compromise to find a consensus solution. Here, specifically, is what we should focus on. The proposed ban plan allows for too much variability and would put too many broadcast stations in the wireless portion of the 600 megahertz band. This will both impair spectrum that will be sold in the forward auction and cause interference between broadcast and wireless services. In my view, the Commission should try to minimize band plan variability. If broadcast stations must be placed in the wireless portion of the band, they should go in the uplink spectrum, not the downlink or the duplex gap. And in order to reach a compromise, we also need to make more information public. Right now, stakeholders and commissioners alike are essentially being asked to take on faith that unless we adopt every aspect of the Commission's proposals, the incentive auction will end in an apocalyptic failure. But I prefer the Reagan approach: trust but verify. Next, I'd like to discuss the FCC's designated entity, or DE program, which has been plagued with abuse. Even though the program is supposed to help small businesses, large corporations routinely try to game the system. And that's why I was disappointed when the FCC recently voted to make it easier for big companies to profit from the program. We were promised FCC action to close loopholes that could be exploited by slick lawyers. Instead, the Commission reopened loopholes that it had closed on a bipartisan basis years ago, loopholes through which a minimally competent attorney could drive a truck. Specifically, the FCC paved the way for DEs to obtain a 35% discount on auction spectrum and then turn around and immediately lease 100% of it to a large incumbent carrier. Now, at the time, we were told that opening up new loopholes in our DE rules was a, quote, attack on economic inequality. But this assertion is baffling. For let's be clear, those who will profit from these new DE loopholes are speculators who are already firmly ensconced in the famed 1%. Case in point, under the new rules, Donald Trump would be allowed to own most of a DE, get a taxpayer-funded discount on spectrum, and then lease all of that spectrum to AT&T or Verizon. So, during the Commission's deliberations, I made simple proposals to prevent this kind of abuse of the DE program. For example, I proposed that anyone making over $55 million a year should be prohibited from owning a DE and getting taxpayer-funded benefits. Unfortunately, the majority rejected this and other common sense reforms. Shifting gears, when it comes to broadband, as Congressman Welch pointed out, too many rural areas are being left behind. Specifically, we are failing areas served by small telecommunications carriers. That's because of a quirk of regulatory history. Our rules governing these carriers give universal service support only to companies that offer telephone service, not standalone broadband service. That's why I put forward earlier this month a specific plan for correcting this historical accident. My plan is based on the principles set forth in a May letter by 115 members of the House of Representatives, led by Congressman Kevin Cramer. This group urged the FCC to adopt an immediate, targeted solution to the standalone broadband problem, and to implement a much simpler and straightforward plan for rate of return carriers than was adopted for price cap carriers. I humbly submit that's exactly what my plan does. It implements a single page of rule changes to existing universal service regulations to solve the standalone broadband problem. These simple amendments would let rural consumers choose broadband as a standalone service. They would give carriers the assurance they need to increase broadband deployment. And critically, they would do all of this within the existing budget. Chairman Walden, Ranking Member Eshoo, members of the committee, thank you once again for inviting me to testify. I look forward to answering your questions and to continuing to work with you and your staff in the time to come.
Thank you, Commissioner Pye. We appreciate your testimony as well. Chairman Wheeler, as you know, LPTV and translators play an important role in providing important information and programming to consumers and businesses, and especially when it comes to the translators serving difficult-to-reach terrain in rural communities. What do you plan to do to minimize the impacts of repacking on LPTV and translators and help ensure that their important programming continues to reach viewers?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We share your interest in making sure that this voice continues. As you know, the spectrum legislation does not create a repacking role, a role in repacking for translators. So the question becomes, what do you do about it? So here's what we're going to do. One, there are channels. We're going to help them find channels if they get displaced as a part of the auction.
Okay.
One of the things that is a reality of an auction is you don't really know where the displacement is going to happen because you don't know the outcome of the auction. So step one is we will work to do that. Step two is that we're going to begin a rulemaking that will allow for channel sharing by LPTV stations, just as we're counting on channel sharing in the broadcast auction. And that kind of technology should provide the similar kind of solution. And thirdly, the rule is constructed in such a way that that they don't have to vacate until the wireless carrier, in fact, is ready to turn up service. So there is a significant buffer of time in there, but we believe that as we help them find new channels and as we have a new rule that allows for channel sharing, that that will be able to mitigate the kind of impact that you're concerned about.
And aren't you going to also give them, like in the DTV transition, there was an opportunity to apply, they got some preference to move the application process? I'll get back to you.
Let me get back to you on
that. It was the displacement relief.
Yeah, there's a so there is a we're laying out a whole process that will help them through this process in finding those kind of new channels.
All right. Thank you. I want to talk about some of the financial issues, because you've spoken about them eloquently before the Appropriations Committee and publicly, and I know that you addressed field agents during a recent agenda meeting regarding the issue of closing the field offices, and you seem to take a special point that your budget comes from Congress and all, which is true. And I want to ask Commissioner Pye, is it true that the Enforcement Bureau's front office management staff has more than doubled size since 2008?
That's my understanding, yes.
Is that true, Mr. Wheeler?
No, sir.
It's not?
No, sir. The enforcement staff is now, I can give you this exact statistic, 20% smaller than it was under Chairman Martin. And that since I have come into office, we have reduced the front office staff by 14%.
Okay. Yeah, we'll want to follow up, because obviously there's a disagreement among you two on this matter. Isn't it also a fact that the Enforcement Bureau has more vehicles than field agents?
Yes, sir. And that is, you know, I'll tell you a story. I went to Anchorage. I've been trying to visit the offices. We have a policy that says you have to have two employees in each vehicle, and because there's one that's driving and one that's working equipment, and you know, it's like texting and driving. We have two people in the Anchorage office, and we have two vehicles.
But we're talking across it's more than just Anchorage.
Oh, yeah, right? No, it's across. This is a reality. And this was one of the problems that we inherited when we walked in the door, that there had been this purchasing. So what we're trying to do now is reposition those vehicles so they will be available for the strike teams when they come in.
And what about, we keep hearing stories that you all have cars and drivers and all that sort of thing at the commission. Is that true?
Yeah. Yeah.
Actually, I don't know about you all. I don't have a car and driver other than my little Prius out there. But is that true?
Mr. Chairman, it's true, although I do try to walk whenever I can.
It shows.
Yeah. But I've got a new Fitbit to track.
Yeah. All right. My time's running.
Not my walking.
But turn to the gentlelady from California.
Thank you. I want to start with Chairman Wheeler. I just want to ask my questions, and then you can respond to them. And I have one for Commissioner Pye. You said in your opening statement that the upcoming incentive auction has, quote, more moving parts than a Swiss watch, and I agree. And one example is the reserve trigger, which I think is really very, very important. And it's critical that we get it right. Because we want to ensure that competitive providers have real access to spectrum. So can you commit to addressing the concerns of the competitive carriers prior to the start of the auction? So that's my first question. My second question is, some in the medical community have suggested that the FCC delay implementation or consideration of its technical rules for the use of Channel 37 by unlicensed TV white space devices. Now, delay is, I think, highly concerning because this is one of the three channels that tech companies say are at a minimum needed in this band to stimulate and sustain investment in enhanced Wi-Fi. So do you think that that your proposal already adequately protects patients and will prevent harmful interference to hospitals? I think that, you know, those are, I could ask a lot of questions, but I think that those two are really important. And also this year, there, Mr. Chairman, there have been eight broadcast television blackouts involving almost 30 U.S. cities. Can you tell us when the FCC will complete its review of the good faith rules and when we can expect new rules to be put in place to better protect consumers? So those are my questions to you. And a quick one to Commissioner Pai. I read recently, and he's not here, but something that Commissioner O'Reilly said, and it's a quote of his, but it does deal with the FCC's governing principles. And he stated that that one of the FCC's governing principles should be that the Internet is not a necessity in the everyday lives of Americans. And I know that, you know, he brought up that it's not even close to being a human right. I don't think that's the jurisdiction of this committee, human rights. But it's disturbing to me that we would move away from that relative to a principle, and I wanted to know if you agree or disagree, you want to add or subtract from it. So I'll go to Chairman Wheeler first, and then to Commissioner Pai.
Thank you, Ms. Eshoo. Let me see if I can hit those one, two, three.
Mm-hmm.
Reserve trigger,
channel 37.
As far as the
interference
trigger, mm-hmm. is concerned.
And the blackouts.
What we have tried to do is to make sure that there is reserve spectrum available. It's never before done. As Mr. Welsh and others have pointed out, it's an important component of delivering service to rural areas. The question then becomes, after you do that, do you want to create rules that allow people to withdraw from the auction early and not have to pay as much as if an auction had been ongoing? And that's what is being requested. That is not what is currently in our proposal. That we don't think that there should be a quick out. I've got what I want. Let me stop the bidding right now for the reserve spectrum. Secondly, insofar as your Channel 37 and medical devices, we have changed in our upcoming order, we have changed from 180 meters to 380 meters, the distance that an unlicensed device would be allowed close to these facilities that are using Channel 37. That number was arrived at as a result of some studies that were done by the medical telemetry folks. And so that's how that number, why that number was increased. There's a fail-safe in here, however, and that is that, as you know, that all unlicensed spectrum has to go through a coordination process that involves a database where you mm-hmm. get permission to use it, if you will, by knowing that there's nobody there. If that 380 meters is insufficient in a particular area because of some rare equipment they've got or whatever, that database can be adjusted to say, nope, you can't do it here. So I think that what we have done in regard to medical equipment is twofold. One, to expand the absolute blackout area, and two, then to have in there a flexible system that will reflect what reality is and shut down if there is a situation that would cause interference. In regard to your third question regarding TV blackouts and good faith negotiations, we intend to have an NPRM out by September the 4th, as this committee has told us to do, on that topic, and to be discussing exactly what are the full set of issues that should be involved in good faith.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Congressman, for the question. I embrace the FCC's charge as given by Congress. In fact, the first charge in the Communications Act, which is to make available so far as possible to all the people in the United States rapid, efficient, nationwide communication services. And in the digital age, that increasingly, as you know, means broadband. And I believe that not only because I'm a son of rural America, whose parents currently live on the opposite side of the digital divide, but I also have seen it as a commissioner across this country. A few weeks ago, I was in Dillard, Nebraska, population 287, where I visited CNC Processing, a husband and wife meat processing plant that 20 years ago was literally a two-person operation, and now, thanks to a broadband connection, they export at retail to every state in the country and around the world. They export at wholesale to Whole Foods and PGA.
So you're saying you disagree with...
Well, what I'm saying is that I embrace different policies to make sure that broadband deployment is as wide and as deep as possible. I'll leave the semantics for others to debate. I'm focused on our job as enmeshed in Section 1 of the Communications Act.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chair now recognizes the gentlelady from Tennessee, Ms. Blackburn.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Okay, Commissioner Wheeler, I want to thank you for your letter dealing with the spectrum auction and small businesses. We got it yesterday, and I may come back to you with a couple more questions on that. You know my concern, and I appreciate your responses. All right, I think we can all agree that we are for a successful spectrum auction. Everybody agree for that?
Yes.
Okay, I'm so happy we're all on the same page. Make your day, right? Let's talk about the steps. And Commissioner, you were just laying out some of the steps you thought were necessary. Let's back it up a little bit. And I think when you look at the CTIA report that came out, and Mr. Chairman, I want to submit that for the record if no one has put that into the record.
Without objection.
Okay. I think that the prelude to a successful auction and to the steps that you just articulated is to know how much spectrum that you have. And we know federal agencies are squatting on a lot of spectrum and that they're not utilizing it. They are sitting on it just in case they think they might want to do something with it. And when you look at 13 years between the auction and the deployment, that is a lot of time. And you look at the increased usage that we're expecting, I think that it is dangerous to, first of all, not inventory and know exactly what you've got. So, Mr. Chairman, to you, have you inventoried the federal agencies and do you know how much spectrum they're squatting on, and what you can recoup?
First of all, Ms. Blackburn, I'd like to identify with exactly what you're talking about. We
okay.
share the same goals.
I'm so excited that we agree on something.
Well, this is
a good day.
Violent agreement as well.
Good.
When I was president of CTIA, I happened to be the guy that negotiated the first deal with the government to repurpose Defense Department spectrum. Here's what I found as a way of answering your question about squatting. The Corps of Engineers, for instance, said they were fully utilizing a piece of spectrum because once a month it took a reading on a dam level.
Right.
I don't think that's fully utilized. So the question we have to work through is how do you encourage federal agencies and all users to think in terms of what is full application. So the answer is, we know who uses what spectrum. The specific use inside that spectrum, however,
okay.
is something that the licensee controls.
Okay, I don't want to run out of time. Now, if you know who has how much spectrum, have you put this into one report? Mr. Pye, Commissioner Pye, have you seen a report that says this is how much that is out there? Could you quantify a number?
I have not seen a particular report about how federal users are actually using the spectrum they have.
And how much they have?
And it would be very helpful to have that.
I think it would, too, before we get too far down this road. What I would like to ask you to do is quantify this And you and I know, all of us know, the way you can repack this and tighten it up, you can better utilize the spectrum. But these federal agencies, I got to tell you, we've just done an IG report on wasteful spending and not following what the IG has asked them to do, looking at 4 years of these IG reports. If you don't force the issue, they're not going to take the action. And spectrum is a very valuable commodity right now. And we cannot allow federal agencies, through laziness or lack of creativity or lack of innovation, to squat on the spectrum. So before we get too far afield with the 350 megahertz auction and further, I would like for you to come back to us and say, this is what each of these different departments has. And this is what their utilization is. And this is how we can pull that back and redeploy this into the marketplace and auction it. Because if we need a federal override for something, just like with the AM ban, come back and do something like that, but don't let them squat on this spectrum. Mr. Pye, before my time has run out, I will come back for the second round. You'll be.
All right, gentle ladies, time's expired. We'll now go to the gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Pallone.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman Wheeler, I have three questions in three different areas I want to try to get in, so I'm going to ask you to respond fairly quickly if you can. You committed that the FCC would complete a proceeding by the end of this year to make our wireless networks more resilient. This deals with communications and emergencies, and I wanted to thank you again for that commitment. Last week, former Commissioner Edelstein promised that the tower industry would work closely with your staff to install new rules for network resiliency. We're approaching the heart of hurricane season, and the third anniversary of Sandy's almost upon us. So what is the status of the FCC's proceeding on network resiliency?
So we are working with the industry on that, Mr. Pallone. It is essential that a tower be able to stand up. I think we probably also have to address the backup power issue, because if you don't, if the tower is standing but there's no juice to it, it's not worth anything. So these all fit together into a total package, and I'd be happy to do a more detailed response to, on that if you would like.
Okay. If you do have something you could update us with now through the chairman, I would like to maybe have a written response if we could.
Without objection.
All right. Thank you. Then the second question is with regard to designated entities. In my opening statement, I mentioned I support your recent decision to modify the FCC's designated entity rules. And since the rules have passed, however, I've heard criticism that just as the FCC closed some loopholes, it opened others. So how do you respond to those critics that question these decisions?
Well, I think that we have tightened up the rules substantially, and we'll be happy to discuss the specific ways in which we have done that. The key thing is also, if you take a look at, and I've got to be real careful at how I talk about this because it is a pending proceeding, but if you look at what is currently on the record with regard to the DEs and their relationship with DISH in the AWS 3 auction, we used a totality of circumstances test that had never been applied before to say, we don't think that that's a good idea at a staff level. That's coming to the commission. So again, I have to rule on that, so I won't go any further. But the fact of the matter is that we then took that totality of the circumstances and put it into the DE rules in this rewrite that we just did. And so I think that we have shown that there is a total picture you have to look at, one, and two, that we have the whatever it takes to step up and blow the whistle and say, that's not right.
Okay. With regard to the incentive auction and consumer outreach, as we head towards the incentive auction in the early part of next year, I become concerned about whether consumers will be prepared for the transition. In many ways, this education effort will be even more difficult than the one we face with the digital TV transition, because we don't have funding for consumer outreach this time, and we'll have to deal with a flash cut. So I've raised this issue with the National Association of Broadcasters, and I can say that they committed to working with us to start planning on how best to reach out to consumers. My question is, can you commit to working with us and the broadcasters to devise a comprehensive plan to ensure that consumers will know what they need to do to continue to watch over-the-air TV?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You actually answered all this in 4 minutes, so I will yield back the balance of
well
my
done.
Time.
Chairman now recognizes gentleman from Texas, Mr. Barton, up next.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you and the ranking member for this hearing. Thank our two commissioners, the chairman and Commissioner Pay, for being here. I am one of the advocates for low-power television, and as we all know, they don't have any real standing in this repackaging of the spectrum if the mainline broadcasters give it back. But they do have a product. They have provided valuable service to the country, and I'd like to see them helped in some way, if at all possible. So my question to both of you, we'll start with the chairman and then Commissioner Pye. What can be done to ensure that we still have low-power television once this repackaging is complete?
Thank you, Mr. Barton. And I'd like to associate myself with this position that you've taken. Low power is an important voice in the community, and translators as well. I set up a special meeting with low power operators out at the NAB last year at their big convention to make sure that I was hearing from them and we were talking about it. I think that there are multiple things that we can do inside the statutory constraint that you referenced. One is that we will help them find new channels after the moving of the first of all, we don't know which low powers are going to be affected because we don't know what's going to happen in the auction. We don't know what's going to be available for them to move, so we don't know what's going to happen in the auction. So we all have to kind of sit in limbo and watch for that. But then even beyond that, we are going to begin a rulemaking in which we will allow low power and translators to share a channel, just like we're allowing licensees, broadcast licensees, full power licensees, to share a channel. And that will create, that will take advantage of the benefits of digital and create another path.
So you do see that there will still be a role for low power television?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mr. Commissioner Pye?
Congressman, I share your assessment and the chairman's assessment that low-power television provides valuable service in Texas, Utah, Nebraska, all across this country. And that's why I flagged almost 3 years ago the importance of making sure that within the statutory constraints, the FCC does what it can in the context of the incentive auction, especially in markets where we don't need the spectrum, to help them stay in business. My concern is, however, that certain of the policy cuts that we are on the brink of making might end up impairing LPTV. And the vacant channel proceeding is one example of that, where the FCC has said, okay, if there's a vacant channel or two vacant channels available after the incentive auction, then we'll reserve those for unlicensed uses. And, you know, not to denigrate, obviously, the importance of unlicensed, but nonetheless, this is the TV band that we're talking about. And if LPTV translators, stations don't have a place to go, it seems to me that we should do what we can to prioritize their staying in business.
Thank you. Thank both of you. And with that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Chair now recognizes a gentlelady from California, Ms. Matsui, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. I'm just going by the list that your staff.
I was here well before the gap.
Yeah,
well,
I'll give my 2 minutes to Mr. Doyle. I had a minute 55.
I'm just going by the list your staff provided. So.
I don't want to get in the middle of this.
We'll go with whatever you want. You don't go in order.
If Mr. Doyle will vote for my bill
I'll
to repeal the ban on crude oil exports.
I'm going to yield to Ms. Matsui. Go ahead.
I'll go with, I'm just going by their list, so your list. So go ahead, Ms. Matsui.
Thank you very much. And Mr. Doyle, thank you very much, too. Chairman Wheeler, after next year's incentive auction, the FCC would have implemented the last auction Congress identified in the 2012 Spectrum Act. Yet consumer demand for wireless services that rely on spectrum continues to explode, and we know it takes a long time to plan for any new spectrum auction. Mr. Chairman, do you agree that we need to create a spectrum pipeline for the next decade?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, what do you think are the first steps for the policymakers to consider?
Well, I think that you and Mr. Guthrie have pointed a way towards that by providing some congressional oversight and encouragement in the process. As Ms. Blackburn indicated, clearly the FCC has a role to say, okay, where are the current allocations? But it then goes to the executive branch to determine the allocation within the specific executive agencies and to answer those questions. I would look forward to working with, and we do have a good working relationship with NTIA and to try and address these issues. And I think that this is something that both NTIA and the FCC can work together on. But I also need to be really candid and say that the kind of leadership that you and Mr. Guthrie are showing, that this committee has shown in keeping the spotlight on, in keeping the pressure on, is essential to paying attention to things downtown.
Well, we intend to keep the spotlight on, so thank you. Congress tasked the FCC with balancing many priorities in the upcoming incentive auction, unleashing new spectrum for licensed mobile broadband, protecting consumer access to local broadcasting, and creating new opportunities for unlicensed spectrum use. If done right, the FCC can ensure that the incentive auction clears a significant amount of beachfront spectrum needed to fuel our wireless economy while protecting over-the-air broadcasting and preserving the chance for unlicensed innovation. I know a lot of concerns have been raised and that the FCC is scheduled to make some key decisions at your August meeting. Chairman Wheeler, what is the FCC doing to make sure stakeholders can feel confident in the incentive auction?
Well, thank you, Congresswoman. You know, the challenge of the incentive auction is it's like a very complex crossword puzzle, except for the fact that there's no picture on the front of the box, okay?
Yeah.
and so what we have been trying to do is to make sure that of all the parties that are interested, that they can walk away with a solution. It may not be what they have come in and asked for. That is, a person who used to also go in and ask the FCC to do things my way on spectrum auctions, I know it doesn't always have to be that way, but you need to make sure that, for instance, as Ms. Eshoo and I discussed for medical devices, that you have an answer there, that you have an answer for wireless mics, that you have an answer for unlicensed spectrum. And all of these have to balance out. And I believe that the item that we're bringing forward contains that kind of balance. Would I like to tweak it here or tweak it there? Certainly. But you push here and something busts over here. So I think that the spectrum auction team headed by Gary Epstein and Howard Simons have done an excellent job in wading through all of this.
Okay. I'm going to ask you too, are we on track to see the incentive auction successfully completed next year in a way that preserves the goals that Congress intended?
Yes, ma'am.
Good. Okay, I'm a longtime advocate for modernization of the Lifeline program. Broadband is a necessity, whether it's applying for a job, growing a small business, or parents helping their kids with homework. And I applaud the FCC for starting a rulemaking earlier this year to bring Lifeline into the 21st century. Mr. Chairman, what are the next steps for Lifeline reform?
I hope that we will have rulemaking to follow up on the notice of proposals we're making as soon as comments and reply comments are closed and we can sift through them and move forward. But I think that, and let me address an issue that Commissioner Pai was dealing with a moment ago. Broadband is the information pathway of the 21st century. And to deny access to that is to deny access to the 21st century.
Right.
And I think we need to have policies that make sure that everyone in America has access to that essential pathway of the 21st century.
I agree with you. Thank you very much, and I yield back.
Gentlelady's time's expired and yields back. Chair now recognizes the vice chair of the subcommittee, gentleman from Ohio, Mr. Latta.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And again, gentlemen, thanks for being here. Commissioner Pai, if I could start my questions with you. We all know that consumers are offered an array of video choices today and new internet-delivered options. are also complemented by the growing use of consumer apps to watch traditional TV on mobile devices. As a result, it seems that more online entertainment options such as Netflix and other over-the-top providers have transformed the marketplace. Let me ask these couple of questions. With that said, Commissioner, what is your assessment of the video marketplace, and can you remember a time when consumers have had so much choice in that market?
Congressman, thanks for the question. I can't think of a time when consumers of video services have ever had it better. Having grown up in the era of three broadcast stations and no satellite and no cable, I can tell you that now, when I can power up Crackle on my laptop at wherever I want on whatever device I want, it's really a benefit. And I think that's part of the reason why I came out a couple of weeks ago and I said that I don't think that the FCC needs to regulate so-called over-the-top video. And that's consistent with what the Digital Media Association, which represents Apple, Amazon, Pandora, Sony, YouTube, and others, said just last week. This is not a marketplace that's failed. It's thriving, and let's leave well enough alone.
So in your opinion, then, that's what's driving the innovation?
Absolutely. And that's one of the great things about the broadband revolution is that all these business models are thriving because everyone can deliver these services over the internet.
Okay, let me follow up with this. Should the government be out there picking winners and losers in this space or trying to impose new technology mandates to potentially slow that innovation and limit that choice?
Absolutely not. I think the worst thing the government could do would be to regulate either the entire marketplace or pick out particular business models for disparate regulatory treatment. That'll simply serve to distort the marketplace, and we'll never know which business model consumers really would prefer.
Well, thank you. Turning to you, Mr. Chairman, if I may, you know, my district, Northwest West Central Ohio, and you're kind of familiar with it in your days back in Ohio, I have a large number of community hospitals and other larger hospital associations in my district. And a number of these hospitals have expressed a very serious concern to the commission regarding the technical rules for the use of the Channel 37 by unlicensed TV white spaces devices. It has already been decided that Channel 37 will be available for use by unlicensed devices and part of the incentive auction proceedings. However, technical rules that provide or protect wireless medical telemetry service WMTS systems also allow for the safe use of the TV white spaces devices that have not been mutually agreed upon. Let me ask you, do you agree that because wireless devices could cause harmful interference to hospital operations and jeopardize patient safety, is vitally important that all parties have the opportunity to work cooperatively to reach a consensus industry agreement on this issue before the commission considers it in the August open meeting?
So I agree that there is a technological challenge that we have to make sure that we deal with. And I believe that we have a belt and suspenders approach to that. The belt is to say that 380 meters from such a site is a no-go zone, which is essentially tripling of where we were before in response to what the WMTS folks have said and some of the trials they've run up in Minnesota. But the suspenders are also that the database that is the coordination database that must be used for unlicensed purposes, if there is a problem in Northern Ohio in a particular area, that information gets fed into the database, and that then becomes a no-fly zone. And so what we've put in place is hard rock and flexibility that is going to deliver the kind of security that I think that both you and we are looking for.
But do you think they have then enough time to make sure they get that information to the commission before your August meeting? Do you think there's enough time? Because, you know, the 27th July, that or 28th, that we're right at that point.
So they have just submitted to us additional information from these field tests, and it was based upon that we altered what our proposal is. This is not an issue that hasn't been being dealt with since you passed the Spectrum Act. I mean, this is something that has been going on for multiple years. Their tests were really helpful in that regard. That's why we tried to make sure that we harmonize with the kinds of things that they've discovered in those tests and provide the flexibility to move in and do something if, in fact, there is an aberration. I mean, this kind of goes to Ms. Blackburn's point about sharing. This is the whole reality about sharing, that we want to create a structure that says that you can deal with the aberrations. And this committee told us in statute to do that. And that was a wise decision on your part, and we're following through on that.
Well, thank you. Mr. Chairman, if I may, I'd like to submit for the record a statement from the American Hospital Association.
Without objection.
Thank you.
Chair now recognizes the gentleman from Vermont. Oh, just kidding. Mr. Doyle, well, Pennsylvania.
That would have really gone bad.
Chairman, if your goal was to get his attention, you succeeded.
Just want to make sure he's away. Mr. Doyle.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Gentlemen, welcome. Commissioner Pye was just listening to your opening statement where you were lamenting how you and Commissioner O'Reilly have all these wonderful ideas that are met with either no response or no. And I just want you to know, we on the Democratic side, we're feeling your pain. It's called being in the minority. So,
not at the end.
Yeah,
just for a second. We've been informed by the folks that do the streaming, Mr. Wheeler. If you could pull that microphone closer.
Yes.
In the internet age, they're not able to hear you quite as well. So,
and thank you, Ms. We feel your pain. I just want you to know, Chairman Wheeler. I have questions for you. I know, like me, you're a strong advocate for a competitive telecommunications marketplace, and you've been a great advocate in moving these long-stalled issues forward. I have a number of questions and concerns about the special access proceeding. First, I'm concerned that the window for moving forward on special access reform is narrowing, particularly with this latest extension of the comment window. Additionally, I've heard that the FCC still hasn't made the data from the special access data request available to the stakeholders. With the comment deadline looming, when will the stakeholders be able to access this data in order to make fully informed comments for the proceeding?
Thank you, Mr. Doyle. I don't know the specific date. We will announce a specific date. I can't freeform it here, but obviously there have been multiple challenges with special access that start with the collection of data that was thwarted for years, and we were finally able to begin collecting that data. Insofar as we will make sure that that data is on the record and on the record in a timely manner. And I share your interest in wanting to make sure that we have an opportunity to address the special access question, but it needs to be fact-based.
Mm-hmm. I mean, can you give us any idea when you anticipate the commission taking action on the proceeding? I mean, are we talking, is it going to be in my lifetime?
Sir, I hope it is while I am chairman, and that is a shorter period than your lifetime.
Let me ask you another thing. Like a lot of people on this committee and our ranking member, Ms. Eshoo, I also have concerns about the trigger for the spectrum reserve and the incentive auction. We've all been working hard to ensure that this auction will enhance competition for wireless broadband and that consumers will reap the benefits of lower prices and greater innovation. To that end, what is the commission doing to address the concerns that many of us have about the reserve trigger, particularly in regard to the trigger coming into play so late in the auction?
Well, the issue of, let me be sure which trigger you're talking about. Are you triggering the assignment round issue, or are you triggering the go ahead. Do you want to?
No. The
question then becomes, are you going to cut back on the amount of bidding that goes on for reserve spectrum? And we have taken the position that you should not. That, first of all, the reserve has been created. That in itself is a huge step that there are a lot of people on this committee and on the commission disagree with. Then the question becomes, do you want the auction to function through the whole process, or do you want to truncate it for a quicker trigger for this spectrum while the other spectrum auction keeps going. And it seems to me that what that ends up doing is reducing participation in the auction. It probably reduces the prices people will pay, because it means that here in the reserve, you know, you stop while the bidding keeps going on up here in the unreserved. And I think an auction is something that proceeds to a conclusion, not an auction that gets terminated to favor one party or another. And so the establishment of the reserve is a huge point. I think now what we should not be doing is picking winners and losers inside that reserve.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Chair now recognizes the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Shimkus, for five.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Welcome. You both agree that to facilitate rural broadband deployment really is going to take USF reform. Is that correct? Would you?
Yes, sir.
And
I think we both
Commissioner
agree on
Pye?
That.
Yes, sir.
And Commissioner Pye, in your opening statement, you mentioned some principles. Can you restate those real quickly again for me? I caught a couple of them, but I didn't.
So with respect to my rural broadband plan, it would be a twofold plan. First and foremost would be targeted changes to our universal service rules to allow essentially rate of return carriers to get universal service support for the cost that they incur for deploying broadband in rural areas. And so currently, that support only extends to voice service. I would let them get that support if they offered broadband as a standalone service. Secondly, creating a voluntary path where rate of return carriers could, at their option, get into a similar Connect America fund that we have for price gap carriers. And obviously, the so-called ACAM model in that regard isn't perfect, but nonetheless, if rate of return carriers find it to be preferable, they should be given a limited window to be able to do that.
Thank you. Chairman Wheeler, these are all kind of rural, you know, questions for rural service. So it's really appealing to the constituency. I represent about a third of the state of Illinois, so it's like a lot of the rural areas. So this is on this drop call issue still. I mean, I go to some of my either family-owned phone companies or the co-ops that I still have out there. And I think we've talked about it the last couple of hearings that we've been with. And the intermediary carriers called the least cost routers. They seem to be the problem. Can you tell me how we're going to, because you know these companies, they get blamed. The call gets dropped. It's an intermediate carrier that's doing it, and it causes all sorts of problems.
Thank you, Congressman. Yes, and you put your finger on it. It's the intermediate carrier, and it's the failure on the part of the major carriers to police their subcontractors, if you will. So we've done several things. First of all, there used to be a game that got played where they would give a false ring, you know, to pretend the call was being completed when it really wasn't. We've got a rule in place saying that's out of business. Secondly, is that we've been enforcing this. Within the last few weeks, we fined Verizon $2 million and required them to do $3 million of additional improvements to stop this, because in 26 rural areas, they weren't paying attention to this, which is the heart of the problem. It's this going to what you call the intermediate carriers that they need to be paying attention to. And thirdly is that we have a data survey out there right now to try and identify exactly what the extent and other causes might be, so that we can take additional action if warranted. But yes, sir, we understand that the call completion is a serious issue and we want to be all over it.
Well, that's good, because we're going to the August break. And I know they'll have
you're going to hear about it.
They're going to come visit me again during the break, and they're going to ask. And so I'm glad I got a chance to ask a question and continue to address this issue. Last question, Commissioner Pye, when it comes to the IP transition and the ability to upgrade technologies, we kind of talked about that earlier, do all providers face a regulatory level playing field when it comes to making upgrades and provide their customers with the newest technologies?
Congressman, I don't think they do. I think that some segments of the industry face no barrier to deciding to deploy next-generation infrastructure that connects people with digital opportunities. On the other hand, another segment faces antiquated rules that essentially require them to maintain the networks of yesterday, the copper-based TDM networks. And obviously, every dollar they have to spend maintaining those networks is, by definition, a dollar they can't spend deploying fiber that would allow them to compete with others. And so that's why I've said that, look, if we want to have more broadband competition, let's have a level playing field, regulatorily speaking, in which every single provider has the strongest possible incentive to deploy fiber to the home, to compete for that customer's attention.
Great. And I'll just end on, Chairman Wheeler, thank you for your work on 911. I'm glad we talked prior, and I look forward to getting together with Ranking Member Eshoo.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, there's always work to be done in this field. And
would you yield just
I would.
For
yep.
10 seconds? Thank you. I thank the gentleman, and we're going to work together on that. How does the commission come up with the amount of what a fine is going to be? I mean, in one case, it's $100 million. You just mentioned $2 million. These are considerable sums. So how do you – do you have a set of rules around that or –
For some kinds of issues such as Lifeline, there is a schedule. For others – it is a, again, totality of the circumstances kind of a situation where you make a judgment call.
And you're the one that makes the call?
Yes, ma'am. Mm-hmm.
Time's expired. Now go to the gentleman from Vermont, Mr. Welch, for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much. I thank both of you for joining us today. Chairman Wheeler, universal service, really important issue, and I know that you've been implementing some reforms, and I'm asking you to tell us what's the status of that, and what are you doing to make sure at the FCC that public resources are being responsibly used? And actually, you can both answer that.
Thank you, Congressman, because Commissioner Pai and I share the belief that he's been talking about here insofar as the dichotomy between narrowband and broadband, and that, mm-hmm. that needs to be fixed. I think I go a little further in my approach than Commissioner Pai does. I have developed what I've now started calling the Walden Rule. Because,
oh, please.
Because I read the other day that you said, Mr. Chairman, quote, that USF should spend money where no one else will spend. And that is a core principle. And as this committee has been telling us so often, you need to review what our rules are.
Right.
The fact that we're spending money for... To subsidize the telephone company around Disney World, just because we always have, doesn't make a lot of sense. The fact that we have no guidelines for operating expenses, we just had a man in Hawaii go to jail for tax fraud. He is a provider of a recipient of universal service, rural universal service funds. And it ended up that he was charging his family's education expenses to universal service, and the people were having to pay for it. We ought to have some standards for what is in OPEX. We ought to have some standards for what is in CAPEX. I was just asked the other day to approve a waiver for a universal service trial to a company that could not produce audited financial statements. That's wrong. Right. This isn't my money. This is the people's money. We need to get it out. That's why Commissioner O'Reilly, Commissioner Clyburn, and I are working together on a bipartisan package of reforms for how we're going to deal with making sure that rate of return carriers have what Commissioner Pai, I think, has called a two-track solution, and that is that we have a model that deals with the new broadband realities, and then we have a review of what the standards ought to be for the old system.
Right.
And we're moving down that path.
Let me hear a little bit from Commissioner Pai. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Congressman, I think you captured the sentiment perfectly in your opening remarks when you said that when it comes to broadband, rural service should be there and be high quality. And that's exactly why I have proposed this plan, to make sure that when it comes to rural Americans, we don't leave them on a so-called slow lane when it comes to broadband. We give them the exact same opportunity they would have whether they are in Montpelier or in New York City. And my concern, however, is that given the time frame that we have committed to, which is to get this done by the end of the year, I think it would be better to embrace the approach that Congressman Kramer and over 100 other members, including 20 members of this committee, embraced, which is to have a targeted solution to the standalone broadband problem. I completely agree with the chairman. There are abuses in the system that need to be corrected, and I stand willing and able to work with him and the other commissioners to change that. But we can't let the necessary and the perfect be the enemy of the good.
Well, thank you very much. You know, the other thing, Lifeline, my view is that it's a really important program, but there is fraud, there is abuse. And one of the things that happens around here is that out of frustration, when there is fraud and abuse, sometimes we attack the very existence of the program rather than reform it. And I think where there's bipartisan agreement is that anything we can do to limit fraud and abuse, obviously we want to do. What's the progress on Lifeline?
So thank you, Mr. Welch.
That's for both of you.
We are going to have rulemaking on Lifeline hopefully before the year is out. It depends on the comments and everything that we receive, and it begins with overhaul. I mean, there are two problems with Lifeline. One, it was designed wrong, and two, it was overseen wrong. Other than that, everything's fine. But it was designed wrong. I mean, so for instance. And I must say this was put in place by a previous administration, okay, which we have inherited. It is ridiculous to have the people who are benefiting from the receipt of the funds be those certifying that the folks getting them are the right folks. It is ridiculous that you not require those people who are receiving the funds to keep records. And on the administration side, it is ridiculous that you not have a database for duplicates, and that you not put structures in place to be able to. So what we've done since we came in, 25% reduction in expenditures on Lifeline. 20 million people who were inappropriately on it are no longer on it. And $100 million in penalties. But so we've done what we can to fix the oversight. What this rulemaking is going to do is continue that and fix the underlying rule problems.
Thank you. My time is up, but I don't know if you want to let Commissioner Pai add anything.
You might address the eligibility database. I don't think we got to that. Commissioner Pai.
Well, Congressman, I obviously support the chairman's vision, at least, of having a more fiscally responsible program. My problem, however, is that we didn't adopt some of the more basic reforms, for example, capping or putting a budget on the program as every other universal service fund has. A targeting broadband adoption, which is really the critical issue, we want these funds to go to connecting people who are offline to help them get online. But currently, 34% of American households, over 40 million households, are eligible for the program. And so if we're going to modernize the program to target broadband, let's make sure we have fiscal responsibility measures in place, and let's make sure we target the help to people who really need it. And that's, I think, an important conversation to have.
What about the eligibility database? Where are you on that?
The duplication database we have in place and operational, and it's working quite well. Insofar as the eligibility database, the issue is our ability to get access to data held by state agencies, principally, and we're in the process of working our way through that. Okay.
That's something we need to get done, obviously.
I agree.
We'll go now to the gentleman from New Jersey, Mr. Lance, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioner Pai, I want to speak with you about the FCC's recent order regarding the TCPA. You stated in your dissent that the attempt to modernize it, quote, is likely to leave the American consumer, not to mention American enterprise, worse off. Can you elaborate to the committee how you believe the commission may not have gotten this correct and what it should have done to protect the American consumer?
Thank you, Congressman, for the question. I begin from the premise that unwanted robocallers are a plague on the American consumer. I don't want to get those calls. I know the chairman doesn't want to get them. Nobody wants to get them. My problem, however, with the commission's order is that it takes us in the opposite direction. For one thing, it exempted entire industries from the TCPA. So now, for example, the prison payphone industry can robocall you. Additionally, it dramatically expanded the range of devices that are now considered to be autodialers. So now if you use your smartphone to make a telephone call, that's technically an autodialer subject to the TCPA. Similarly, it opened the loopholes for reassigned numbers. There are 37 million numbers that are reassigned every single year. A lot of legitimate businesses have no reason to know if they have that number in stock and they have the prior phone number's owner, the consent of that owner. They have no reason to know that that number has been reassigned. Nonetheless, they can face TCPA liability. Those are the kinds of loopholes that I think are simply going to generate even more litigation. And litigation has already become a flood. There were 14 class actions filed in 2008. Last year alone, there were something like 1,918. And so my concern is that we're opening up a lot of these loopholes. At the same time, we're not cracking down on the really bad actors, which are the unwanted robocallers. For example, we didn't create, contrary to what Wyatt would have preferred, to create a safe harbor for carriers to allow them to develop a technology to block foreign robocallers. We didn't take more aggressive enforcement measures, despite the fact that we got 96,000 complaints last year for violations of the Do Not Call Registry. In the first 7 months of this year, even though I called for it in January, we've had one citation from the Enforcement Bureau against the Do Not Call Registry of violators, and that's unacceptable to me.
Why do you think the commission did not have a safe harbor rule?
I'm not sure why, to be honest with you, but what I can tell you is that it's created tremendous uncertainty among the host of legitimate businesses that have their consumers' consent and want to communicate important information. Everyone from restaurants to the Los Angeles Lakers have faced class action lawsuits for trying to communicate with people who have voluntarily communicated with them.
Thank you. Chairman?
Thank you, Mr. Lance. Several things. First of all, we wanted to make sure that, let me just go down Commissioner Pai's list, exemptions. We wanted to make sure that there were opportunities for if your doctor or a hospital needs to do something because of a medical emergency or your bank needs to contact you because of fraud or something like that, that there should be those kinds of exemptions in. They're not big loopholes. Secondly, on the question of you get to make one mistake and discover that the Lance phone has been transferred. You don't have to do this 3, 4, or hundreds of times as some people have. You can say, excuse me, this is not the number, and just provide notification. Thirdly, it was the Congress that created the private right of action, and that is something that is a decision that is out of our hands. But to your key point about the safe harbor and the carrier solution, specifically, we addressed that because the carriers were saying to us, we're afraid to offer blocking services that because you might charge us with blocking costs doing just that, which would be a violation of our rules. And so we amended the rules to say, no, that is not a violation. And we now have a workshop coming up where we're bringing the carriers and other affected parties in to sit down to say, okay, exactly how do you do it? Because how you handle a VoIP call is different from how you handle a TDM call. And how do you put those in place? But this is something that where we have said to the carriers, our rules now specifically allow you to block calls where you're requested by consumers. Please do.
Thank you. Any sir rebuttal, Commissioner Pai?
Congressman, I would simply point out that the safe harbor wasn't given enough granularity, and to say the least. And if a carrier is willing to trust an agency that's proven itself to be more than willing to fine a company up to $100 million for the violation of rules that don't exist, I would urge them not to rely on a safe harbor that doesn't provide much guidance at all.
You're not encouraging folks not to not block calls. Are we together on the fact that, yes, we want them to be blocking calls?
On that, we agree, which is precisely why I propose that the agency create a very detailed, specific guideline for how the safe harbor would operate.
I don't want to send mixed messages. And they say, oh, no, we can't do it.
Thank you. My time has expired, and thank you for the rebuttal, the sir rebuttal, the sir rebuttal, and sir rebuttal.
And feel free to call either one of us at home if you'd like to follow up.
That's right.
I've got a pre-recorded message. We'll... send you. I do think there are issues the committee will proceed to talk about on this issue, though, as it relates to democracy and nation.
Thank you, Mr.
Chair. We'll go now to Mr. Loebsack, Iowa, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I really just want to come back to one issue that was already brought up, but and have you elaborate a little bit on that, Mr. Wheeler. But before I actually ask that specific question, I always just like to talk about rural broadband, as you might imagine, both of you, and just how important it is for places like Iowa, but not just places like Iowa, just all over the country. And I know we have bipartisan support to make sure that we have rules in place, make sure that we have programs in place, incentives in place to expand that broadband availability to so many folks around the country. We know it's an economic development issue. We know it's a health issue. You know, when we talk about the spectrum, for example, issue for hospitals, making sure that, you know, I heard from someone this morning about that, making sure that they have the broadband available and make sure that they can do what they need to do for their patients. We know it's important for education. I often talk about the University of Iowa, how they have a program where they offer AP classes, but it doesn't do any good in those rural areas if those folks cannot access what the University of Iowa offers. And we know that farmers, it's very, very important for farmers to be able to have access to broadband so they can make decisions, obviously, for planning and for their businesses in general, and on and on and on. I was in Centerville, Iowa for one of my 24 town hall meetings on broadband, small town, and there were 27 people at that meeting on a weekday afternoon at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, because it is just so absolutely critical for them to be able to have this broadband coverage. So really my question goes back to what I think was already mentioned. You know, earlier this year, 115 members, myself included, wrote to you, Mr. Wheeler, Chairman Wheeler, urging reform of the portion of the high-cost program that supports small rural broadband providers so that they could receive USF support for lines over which customers opted to purchase only broadband rather than traditional voice service, as is the current practice. The rural broadband industry submitted a data-only broadband reform plan to the FCC in 2013, but the FCC has not yet acted on this plan. Are there issues with the reform plan specifically proposed by the rural broadband industry that prevent the FCC from acting on it as proposed? And if you could just elaborate on that, I'd appreciate it.
Thank you, Congressman. There are, what, something like 114 different carriers in Iowa. I mean, you represent the poster child of the rural challenge for rate of return carriers. It is outrageous that... you know, if you live in rural America, you're 30 times more likely not to be able to get broadband as if you live in an urban area. So there are two components. One is dealing with things through the price cap carriers, and we recently released what'll be $10 billion over 6 years to seven carriers to build their facilities, and I love seeing the headlines that pop up across the country that we get in our report that so and so carrier announces they're going to spend $27 million to bring broadband to this area as a result of our funds. Then we go to the rate of return carriers. The challenge with rate of return carrier and how we deal with it is that the program has been in place for so long and the circumstances have changed over that period. As I say, I agree strongly with Commissioner Pye that this bifurcation between narrowband and broadband doesn't make any sense. But we've got to do better than just slapping that Band-Aid on. We have to be saying, how do we make sure that we can bring this whole program forward? So we sat down with the rural carriers to say, how can we do that? And to try and reach a consensus, because there's a couple of rural carrier associations who don't agree with themselves, as you know. How do you do that? And it's encouraging. Everybody has agreed on this two-prong process that I laid out a minute ago. And I am optimistic that Commissioner O'Reilly and Commissioner Clyburn and myself, who are all working together with the rural carriers to come up with a package proposal, we'll be able to get this done, and that I will be able to live up to the commitment that we made over in the other body to have it done by the end of the year.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Wheeler. Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Chair recognizes gentleman from Kentucky, Mr. Guthrie, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for being here. And my first question is for Commissioner Pye, and it's a three-part. So if you need to, I'll ask if you need to repeat, I can do so as well. But it all flows together. But why do you oppose putting broadcasters in the duplex gap? And why is it important to minimize the number of broadcast stations placed in the wireless portion of the 600 megahertz band after the incentive auction? And I can stop there. Let me give you the three and see if maybe you can answer on one. Why do you believe it's preferable to put broadcast stations in the uplink portion or the wireless band rather than the downlink? And you have suggested that the commission hold an in-bank hearing to discuss issues related to the 600 megahertz plan. Why do you think such a hearing would be helpful?
Congressman, thanks for the question. I was transcribing as quickly as I could, so if I miss one, please do let me know. In terms of putting broadcasters in the duplex gap, one of the things that typically disparate industries, the wireless industry, the broadcasters, and unlicensed advocates agree on, is that placing broadcasters in the duplex gap would be a terrible idea. Wireless companies don't like it because it would impair downlink spectrum, which they've told us is critical, more critical for them in terms of meeting consumer demand. Broadcasters have told us it's not optimal because the duplex gap is the only exclusively reserved spectrum for wireless microphones, which a lot of broadcasters rely on. And unlicensed advocates have told us as well that if you have a full power broadcaster out there, unlicensed devices will get drowned out. And so that's part of the reason why I've said consistently that we need to do what the record suggests, and that is moving them somewhere other than the duplex gap. That raises the question, well, where do you put them? And as between the downlink and the uplink, I don't think there's any question, certainly not in terms of the record itself, that there's tremendous opposition to putting them in downlink. If you think about it, everyone carrying a smartphone around now relies tremendously on downlink spectrum. We're always downloading things from the internet. So putting a broadcaster in the downlink will, first of all, it will impair a lot of the spectrum that's slated to be sold in the forward auction, make it a lot less appealing. Secondly, it will end up causing tremendous problems in terms of interference between broadcast and wireless issues. And here, the 700 megahertz auction is a really cautionary tale. Think about all the efforts that this committee, that the commission had to deal with, because we had broadcasters in Channel 51 and we had wireless carriers in the adjacent A block of the 700 megahertz band. Those issues took a long time to resolve, and it was really challenging. Here we're talking about co-channel in addition to adjacent channel interference. Plus, remember, this is the last spectrum auction, hopefully, we're going to have in some time with respect to this band. So broadcasters placed in downlink will be there essentially permanently. So this is not a problem we'll be able to work around. So that's why I would prefer, based on what I've seen in the record, to place broadcasters, if they have to be put in the wireless band, to be placed in the uplink. Wireless carriers have told us it's technically preferable for a couple of reasons. First, they can minimize the amount of the problems it would cause in terms of interference, because you could just simply put a base station filter on. It would be a lot easier, since base stations are smaller in number, fixed in location, as opposed to putting a filter on a mobile device, which everyone is carrying around and is always moving. So in terms of the on-bank hearing, which I think was your third question, one of the reasons why I think it would be helpful is that the commission has simply not made available enough data in terms of the simulations for these clearing scenarios, the data and assumptions that underlie those simulations. And we've heard from everybody, from licensed advocates to broadcasters to wireless carriers, we need more data and we need to give you more meaningful input before you make a decision. And so that's why I thought, you know, let's just bring them all into a room. Let's have everybody participate. And so then we, the commissioners, can have a fully informed discussion before we vote on August 6th or whenever it is, to make sure that the band plan is right. You know, Congress only gave us one chance to get it right. And if we don't, then I'm afraid the cost could be substantial.
Okay, I'm going to try to get another question in, and for Commissioner Pye as well. So you said hopefully this is the last spectrum auction for a long time, I think you said.
With respect to 600 megahertz, yes.
Well, do you believe enough is being done to ensure there's a long-term national strategy to make additional spectrum available for commercial use? And if not, what else do you believe should be done?
Thanks for the question. I think consistent with what the chairman has said, with Congresswoman Matsui and Congresswoman Blackburn have said, we need to make sure that there's more spectrum in the pipeline. I look at the proliferation of broadband as a commissioner, as a consumer, and I think that's a great thing. I look at it as a commissioner. I wonder, how are we going to supply the spectrum that all these devices connected to the internet are going to need? And that's part of the reason why I've been so bullish about getting more licensed and unlicensed spectrum out there.
You think congressional action is needed?
I think in some cases it might be. With respect to federal users in particular, it would be very helpful. And I know that you and Congresswoman Matsui have been leaders on that, and I thank you for that legislation.
Chairman Wheeler, only about 20-some seconds, but to comment on what he was about, the national, more available spectrum. may not be enough time.
Yes, sir. And I'd like to identify with what you and Congresswoman Matsui are doing. And if we get a chance, I'd like to also respond to your first question as well.
Okay. I only have 9 seconds, so I yield back. Sorry.
Gentleman yields back. Chair now recognizes Gentlelady, Ms. Clark, for 5 minutes.
I thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I thank our ranking member. I, of course, thank our panelists this afternoon for your updates regarding the agency's activities. I have a few concerns that I'd like to have you address, and that one of them worries me a bit, and it is what is not in your testimony. It's how the commission will address continuing challenges in diversity and representation in the media and telecom industries. We're in the 21st century. We look at our nation and its diversity, and I think there's a widespread acknowledgement that what we see in terms of industry is really just not reflective of who we are as a country. So I'd like to ask, first of all, Chairman Wheeler, where's the commission's focus on the completion of the diversity studies? And how can this data be used to create a more nuanced and tailored policies and reforms that advance equity and inclusion? And second to that is, what metrics and accountability structures are in place to ensure that vulnerable populations and their communities will be adequately served through these proposals?
Thank you very much, Ms. Clark. The media report that I have promised to the committee by the middle of next year will include a topic on diversity. It has frankly been an issue that has caught up previous reports. But I think that there is a couple of things we can take up. There is a substantial increase in the number of broadcast licensees since I became chairman, in large part, minority broadcast licensees, in large part because of what we did on the JSA rules. Because those rules were being used to keep opportunity away from minority entrepreneurs. And so I'm proud of that effort. Secondly, is that I think we all have to recognize, as a point that Mr. Latta was raising previously, and the importance of how the television business is changing, and the opportunity that is reflected by over-the-top providers. And there's been a difference up here on whether we ought to do what this committee did for direct broadcast satellite for over the top, and that is to say that you can't hold content back, you can't have various leverage points, because I think over the top programming creates incredible new opportunities for minorities. And lastly, we've been talking a lot about the designated entity rules and the wireless auction. I feel strongly that what this Congress asked us to do was to be creating opportunities for minorities, women, and rural individuals to participate in wireless. And that's what we did in the DE rules, and that the suggestions that have been made by my colleagues on the Republican side actually would have limited the ability for real live DEs rather than hypothetical DEs to participate.
So on the subject of DEs, and Mr. Pyle, Commissioner Pyle, excuse me, I'll have you respond as well. It appears that we've probably cracked the code of only one part of supporting small businesses gain access to capital to enable them to compete in the wireless industry. How can the commission facilitate more secondary market transactions for DEs and other small businesses, especially those owned by women and minorities, with the private sector?
Were you addressing that to Tim? So I think that we need to make sure that again, the JSA rule was very helpful in that regard, and has performed as expected. You know, we have made it clear that when broadcast licensees come in for transfers, and they are complying with the rule which says that they can't now have control of multiple licensees in a market, that we will look favorably upon them selling those assets to minority entrepreneurs. And in fact, that has been successful.
Thank you, Chairman. Commissioner, I've run out of time, but hopefully we can get a response from you as well. Thank you.
Right now, for the record, or whichever?
Probably for the record, because I'm going to keep moving forward, I think.
Okay.
Mr. Olson from Texas, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
I thank the chair, and welcome Chairman Wheeler and Commissioner Pai. Since I've been on the Energy and Commerce Committee since 2011, consumer privacy has been a focus of my work for the people of Texas 22. In the 112th and 111th Congress, that work was done on the Commerce, Manufacturing, and Trade Subcommittee because they had jurisdiction over the FTC. But the FCC has grabbed that authority to regulate the broadband ISPs, taking that from the FTC, and now it's with the FCC. And now it's under this committee's jurisdiction. The good news is you haven't lost me. I'm still with you. But folks back home want to know why. What was the problem with the FTC and broadband ISPs that forced this change? In a matter of time, I'll give you Chairman Wheeler 1 minute, and you, Mr. Pai, 1 minute to respond to his comments. Chairman Wheeler, why was the change necessary?
Thank you, Congressman. As you know, the FTC Act, writ large, says that it does not have jurisdiction over common telecommunications carriers, common carriers. And so when we said that ISPs were telecommunications carriers, it triggered that. What your constituents should know, however, is that we work closely with the FTC. Their jurisdiction insofar as edge providers, and whatever we do, which will be forthcoming in the next few months on our privacy proposals, we will do our best to harmonize so that there is a common set of concepts that govern privacy.
Okay, great. That gave me some time back. Mr. Pai, your response, Commissioner Pai.
Congressman, unfortunately, the FCC's reclassification of internet service providers as common carriers had a twofold hit on consumers. First, it deprived the FTC of jurisdiction, as the chairman has pointed out, because of the common carrier exemption, jurisdiction that the FTC has explicitly been given congressional authorization for under things like COPPA. Secondly, because the FCC then arrogated that issue for itself, unfortunately, our authority under the statute is relatively circumscribed. As you pointed out, Section 222 at CP&I, a pretty narrow, arcane piece of the privacy puzzle, if you will. So we don't actually have any rules in place. And moreover, the guidance, so-called, that we've given out has been completely unhelpful. For example, in May of this year, our Enforcement Bureau put out a guidance with respect to privacy, and it said, and I quote, "The Enforcement Bureau intends that broadband providers should employ effective privacy protections in line with the core tenets of basic privacy protections." What does that mean? I have no idea. ISPs have no idea. Consumers have no idea.
I have no idea.
So I would rather have let the experts of the FTC, who have protected consumers low these many years, handle this issue based on law that you have given them.
And so you believe it's important that the FTC has expertise to handle these issues as opposed to the FCC, correct?
Expertise and legal authority, yes.
Okay. And the chairman talked another issue about privacy and edge providers. Chairman Wheeler, a consumer interest group filed a petition asking you to start a rulemaking to impose consumer privacy protections on edge providers. When are we going to see your response? Do you believe that edge providers should have a different standard of protection than ISPs?
Thank you very much, Congressman. First of all, you know, the commission has for decades been enforcing privacy under the CP&I rules on telecommunications carriers. So it's not as though we just fell into this patch. There is a long history of privacy protection regarding telecommunications carriers. Insofar as extending our jurisdiction to the edge providers, I have said repeatedly that is not our intention. I don't know when the specific response to that specific petition will be coming out. I'll be happy to get you a date. I don't know what the planning process on it is.
Okay, thank you. Commissioner Pai, your response.
I think this is part of the problem when the FCC crossed this Rubicon in February. If you believe, as the majority did at the time, that the internet is a virtuous cycle and you have internet service providers and edge providers interacting with one another to provide a better consumer experience, it would seem to follow logically then that if an edge provider is acting in an anti-competitive or anti-consumer way, then why shouldn't the FCC have the jurisdiction to extend those same rules to internet or to edge providers? And moreover, if you look at the internet conduct standard, it's not clear to me a priori why the FCC should limit its focus on internet service providers. You could easily see a dominant edge provider engaging in anti-competitive conduct. And so that's part of the uncertainty that unfortunately the FCC opened up. And I hope we don't follow that to its logical conclusion.
Well, thank you both. I yield back the balance of my time.
Gentleman yields back the balance of his time. Chair recognizes the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Rush, for 5 minutes.
I want to thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank you and the ranking member for today's hearing. Mr. Chairman, Commissioner Pai, I welcome both of you to today's hearing. So good to see you once again. Mr. Chairman, I want to lift up one of the most troubling and egregious matters that is under the consideration of the FCC. And I am referring to the prison phone call rates. I understand that the FCC is poised to make a ruling on in-state phone rates for prison phone calls. That said, Mr. Chairman, we must stop this immoral practice of avaricious greed and unabashed exploitation of the poor, the very ones least able to afford this phone rate robbery. Additionally, Mr. Chairman, once and for all, we must do away with the practice of site commission kickbacks, and we must cap in-state phone rates. As you know, Mr. Chairman, the prison call industry is a multi-billion-dollar business. And if there is any doubt, I want to call your attention to a recent Huffington Post article entitled, quote, "Prisoners pay millions to call loved ones every year. Now this company wants even more." This article referenced how Securus, a company called Securus, the second largest company in the prison phone call rate industry, Securus bragged to its investors about its $404.6 million future profits on the backs of the very same poor. Mr. Chairman, as you know, I've been fighting this issue for over a decade, and it's now time for the FCC to take action and rein in these predatory practices by capping the rate at 5 cents per minute and eliminating all ancillary fees. But more importantly, Mr. Chairman, the FCC must also be a step ahead of these predatory companies that are right now trying to circumvent the laws by offering video phone calls at the same predatory rates that they offered for phone calls, telephone calls. Mr. Chairman, my question is, when will the FCC rule on this legalized telephonic terrorism?
Thank you very much, Mr. Rush. I agree with you, this is a very serious issue, and you and I can, and people across America, owe a huge debt of gratitude to Commissioner Clyburn, who took this issue, had been sitting on the desk of the FCC for 10 years since Martha Wright filed her first petition, and brought it forward so that there was a decision about interstate. But you know what happens is that whack-a-mole starts getting played here. And okay, we can't do it here, so we'll move it over here. Well, next month we have a decision on that, on intrastate, that we're doing next month. The point that you make about video phones is another legitimate point. I mean, the reality here is that what we're talking about is a monopoly that is granted to prisons to determine how people communicate. And like any monopoly, it ends up being exploitive. And the people who are hurt by that exploitation are the very people who rely on it. And I can assure you, sir, that Commissioner Clyburn keeps our feet to the fire on this, and that I am fully supportive of her efforts.
That's good news, Mr. Chairman, and I'm just apoplectic about this situation, and I don't know. Well, let me move on. If I have my time is up.
Time has expired. Yeah, I should tell you we're going to do a second round of questions. So if you're here for that, there'll be more time. We'll now go to a gentleman from Florida, Mr. Bilirakis, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate it. Thanks to both of you for showing up today, and thank you for your testimony. Chairman Wheeler, in March, we discussed public safety interference complaint responses and a resulting quarterly report, which you thought was a good idea. I know you've provided some information. Have you posted what you provided the committee on the website so the public can see what's going on and what you're doing?
Sure.
You have?
No, I'm saying, would we?
Have you posted online?
I can't answer that question specifically, sir. I'll get you the answer.
Can you get that information to us as soon as possible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And if you haven't, I mean, can you post that online as soon as possible?
I think that's a good point, sir.
Okay, very good. Commissioner Pai, there's been a lot of attention and concern regarding the designated entity auction rules. Do you believe are they now correctly balanced? And if not, what should be done to fix them?
Unfortunately, Congressman, I don't think they are. In fact, the agency has moved in the opposite direction. My principle for this small business program is that it should benefit small businesses. But unfortunately, the agency, having loosened some of the restrictions that were imposed on a bipartisan basis several years ago, has now opened the door for large corporations to abuse the program and, ironically enough, squeeze out a lot of the small businesses, minorities, women, and others, who need access to capital in order to provide facilities-based service. And we saw that in the most recent AWS-3 auction, where small carriers tried to compete, but they weren't able to because a deep-pocketed Fortune 500 corporation used shell companies to prevent them from bidding. And that's part of the reason why I proposed what I thought were pretty common-sense reforms. If you're making in the upper eight figures, you don't need a taxpayer-funded discount in order to participate in a spectrum auction. If you're a genuine small business with less than $15 million of revenue, you don't need more than $50 million of taxpayer-funded bidding credits in order to get spectrum at an auction. If you're a genuine business, you should be able to provide facilities-based service, not simply flip your spectrum to a large incumbent corporation the minute the auction is over. Unfortunately, it fell one vote short on all of those proposals, which would, I submit, have restored faith, public faith, in the small business program.
Thank you. Chairman Wheeler, in the open internet order, you committed to take steps to prevent increases in poll attachment rates that might result from reclassifying broadband. What steps have you taken since the order to prevent such increases, and what additional steps are expected?
Sorry. Thank you, Congressman. That there is a proceeding underway to do that we started in the last, 6 weeks, 8 weeks, somewhere around like that. It's designed to make sure that there is parity between telecommunication service and cable service attachment fees.
Okay. Again, can you continue to update us on this?
Yes, sir.
Appreciate it very much. All right, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Okay. So now we'll go to, Mr. Johnson is next.
Thank you.
For 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chairman Wheeler, in a recent response to questions for the record as to whether you think stakeholders who cannot afford to have regulatory lawyers or lobbyists in Washington, D.C., should also have the same access that other stakeholders have. You made a point that the commission does not have funding for routine field hearings and similar activities. Yet your emissary, Ms. Sohn, has been routinely traveling to various events. In fact, it seems that both you and Ms. Sohn have been wheels up quite frequently in your travels. So let me pose the question this way. Given that you apparently have a robust travel budget, isn't the real issue how you elect to spend the money?
Thank you, Congressman. I think the people who I keep turning down saying, no, I'm not going to come talk, would probably disagree, and my travel is significantly less than other members of the commission. But your point is a well-taken point, and that is that decisions get made. There is a travel budget that each commissioner has. And that is for his or her discretion. There is not.
Okay. Well, you've answered my question. It really is up to your discretion on how you spend the money. So, could you let us know, for the record, how much the FCC has spent on travel in FY 2013, 14, and 15 so far?
By commissioner.
Could you get that back?
By commissioner.
Yeah.
Yes. Sure.
Okay, great. I'd like to see that. Commissioner Pai, I was listening closely to your discussion with my colleague, Mr. Belarakis, regarding the designated entity program. And I'm really struggling a bit with Chairman Wheeler's decision to eliminate the attributable material relationship rule and the facilities requirement in the competitive bidding rules for a couple of reasons, and you pointed those out. You made a compelling case that this sets the state for arbitrage. So how are we going to prevent that from happening? What actions does the commission need to take to make sure that these rural small carriers are able to get the credits that the designated entity program was designed to give them so that they can serve those underserved, unserved areas?
Thanks for the question, Congress. And I think, to be honest, we first need to return to the status quo before the most recent decision, and we need to adopt some common sense reforms to make sure that large corporations don't game the system again. And to be sure, the order did take some of these measures, you know, prohibiting a single corporation from using multiple bidders in the same market in the same auction. But you know, that's low-hanging fruit that's already prohibited by the criminal antitrust laws. I'm talking about genuine reforms of the DE program to make sure that the people who need the help, the people who want to serve folks in Ohio or Kansas, can be able to do that. And you know, I've enunciated some of those reforms, you know, limiting the amount of bidding credits people can get, making sure that large companies can't own a majority of a DE, making sure that we preserve that AMR, as it's known, so that people don't end up flipping all over the spectrum to the entrenched incumbents. Those are the kinds of common sense reforms that don't have a partisan affiliation to them, and I think, you know, I wish the majority had agreed with me.
Yeah, well, I can tell you that that it's a real concern for me, and I'm sure other colleagues that represent rural areas of the country. I've got high school students that don't have access to broadband internet service, and as a result, they have to either go to a public library nearby or some other location, maybe to where they can get a wireless signal or something like that, to do their homework, to do research, to do that kind of thing. And this is 2015, for crying out loud.
If I could just add a coda, that one of the reasons why the facilities-based requirement is so important is because in a lot of cases, the larger providers don't see the business case in building out to that school or to that area, whereas a smaller rural provider who actually does want to connect those folks to the internet wirelessly, they have a strong incentive to make sure that those folks are connected. So when those rural providers are squeezed out because there's no more facilities-based requirement and speculators can come in and take the spectrum and flip it to the big incumbents, that really does impact those consumers.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you. And now we go to the gentleman from Missouri, Mr. Long, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you all for being here today. Mr. Chairman,
on or Chairman Wheeler, on July 24th, 4 days ago, your agency announced that granted with conditions approval of the transfer of control licenses and authorizations from DirecTV to AT&T. We hear much about your agency's 180-day shot clock for reviewing such transfers, yet your agency's conditional grant of approval took over twice that amount of time, as you're well aware, over 400 days. I've got some questions that I'd like to have answers to. Number one, what's the point of the shot clock?
Well, the shot clock is aspirational to begin with, but it is something that we try to manage to. The difficulty in this particular situation was that we were hung up by a court proceeding and a court decision that itself took as long as the shot clock. And so that specifically dealt with the kind of information that we could have on the public record. We had to get through that before we could get to the decision.
Well, on the 170th day of the 180-day shot clock, your agency stopped it for 3 months.
Because of the court decision.
That was the same thing you're talking about, the court decision.
So the reality here is that there is right now pending before Commissioner Pye and me. Have you voted on it yet? I mean, that's not a setup question. I don't know the answer to it.
So voted on what? I'm
sorry. On the protective order. Order.
Well, I just saw it yesterday. So.
Okay. So we have put out an order for to outline how you protect confidential information so that we can be in compliance with the court, so that this will not happen again. And the absence of that was what held up this proceeding.
Okay. Commissioner Pye, same question to you. Do you have the same opinion on why the shot clock was stopped at the 170th day, or what the benefit of the shot clock is?
Congressman, I do have a different view. The agency inflicted a wound on itself, which is why the court had to intervene. The court didn't simply out of whole cloth decide to participate in this proceeding. What happened was, in the context of that transaction and another transaction, the agency decided to try to get all kinds of confidential information from programmers and without any kind of due process. And so the programmers naturally sued. I urged the agency to try to reach a settlement because this information wasn't really necessary to resolution of the issues in the transaction. And a unanimous D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals agreed with me, calling the FCC's decision an unexplained and substantial departure from previous policy. And miraculously, even though they remanded it and told the FCC, look, here's the roadmap you need to follow if you want this information, despite having said the information was critical, ultimately the agency didn't even seek it or rely on it in making the decision. So that's why I've said, look, the shot clock needs to be more than aspirational. It needs to be a rule. Just as there's 24 seconds in the NBA, there should be 180 days, period, for the FCC, with extensions for extenuating circumstances. But nonetheless, we need to give both the public and the parties a lot of certainty as to how the FCC is going to do it.
Okay, let me move on. I've got another question here for Chairman Wheeler. 3 days prior to your agency's conditional grant of approval of the transfer, control of license and authorization from DirecTV to AT&T, the Department of Justice announced that after an extensive investigation, it concluded that the combination of AT&T's land-based internet and video business with DirecTV's satellite-based video business does not pose a significant risk to competition. Although the Justice Department closed its investigation without imposing any conditions on the transaction, your agency announced that it was imposing a number of conditions to address potential harms presented by the combination of AT&T and DirecTV, despite the Justice Department's view that the combination of the two video businesses did not pose a significant risk to competition. What significant risks to competition did your agency identify that the Justice Department apparently missed?
Thank you, Congressman. And we worked closely with the Justice Department on this, and I don't think that there was a sliver of light between us. The reality, well,
how can you say that?
Because we have a different test.
You have a what?
We have a different test. They have an antitrust test that they face. We have a public interest test that we are supposed to measure by. So we have actually two different standards that we measure to. And what was happening here was that in about 25% of the area of AT&T service area, DirecTV was a competitor to AT&T for video service. And so eliminating that competition, the question became, Does that create an incentive then to eliminate broadband competition as well? So what we required was that AT&T expand its broadband coverage, which increased competition for broadband by a significant amount and created an opportunity for those video providers not to have to go through a decreasing choke point.
You just want to see if I was paying attention.
Insofar as
we've got a red light on our backboard, my 5-minute shot clock has expired, so I will be back for round two.
Good.
Chair now recognizes the gentleman from New York, Mr. Collins.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Wheeler, the big issue that I've been involved in is pirate radio, which you may know, and back in early June, pretty much every New York member of Congress, as well as New Jersey, sent you a letter. And while the issue may not be a terrible issue, you know, in some parts of the country, it truly is in New York City, as evidenced by not often you can get 27 members of New York to agree, upstate, downstate. We're like two different worlds. So I guess, to sum it up, we're extraordinarily disappointed that the FCC has clearly said it's not a priority. We got the letter just from you yesterday, and I understand budget concerns, I guess what I'm trying to, the point I want to emphasize is this is an issue, even though it's not to you, and you are the chairman. You know, we really don't appreciate you saying that, as you put in here, the time and expense of pursuing these cases present particular difficulties in the current flat budget environment where the commission's staffing is at its lowest point in 30 years. Overtime is less available, so accordingly, we must prioritize our work based on existing resources and harm to the public. Thus, matters posing an imminent threat to public safety or directly harming large numbers of consumers must take precedence over other matters such as pirate radio. So, I mean, I understand what you're saying, but, you know, what is the size of your budget?
That letter and those particular words, which I wrote, were not designed to say that this is a low priority, but designed to say that first issue is public safety. Pirate radio has to exist inside that, and I believe that we have been very aggressive. So during my chairmanship, we've had 200 private radio enforcements. In the last year, we've had 100 alone.
How many in New York just?
I don't know the exact number, but I would say 90%, maybe not 80% of those. And so what we've done is, and Commissioner O'Reilly, when he was meeting with the New York broadcasters, really focused on that, and he helped us focus on that. So we've formed an interagency working group, task force, to work with the NAB and the New York broadcasters on this issue to make sure.
So you had that meeting, and the fourth point on that that came out was basically that you need more folks in your local enforcement office. That I think that point number four of that hearing was additional FCC enforcement options.
That was one of the things that they...
But in another hearing, we talked about how you've been reducing the local field offices and pulling those folks back to headquarters. And some of us would presume that's to be ready to enforce Title II, which we can disagree on as well. But it seems a little disingenuous. And our big concern is words are words, actions are actions. And the actions have not convinced me, and I think other members, that it is at all a priority. Your letter, while it said maybe someday if we've got nothing else to do, we'll see what we might want to find in pirate radio, it's a low priority for the FCC.
If that's how you interpret it, I apologize, because that's not what was meant. There is, so the New York office, the Boston office, and the Miami office, which is where pirate radio tends to exist, those three areas. This is a whack-a-mole. I keep using the whack-a-mole today, but this is a whack-a-mole kind of
situation.
Well, sure,
that's what pirate radio is.
Where people keep moving around. Now, so one of the things I think that I encouraged in that letter is that Congress can also be helpful, because we can't go. We can go and shut somebody down, and he or she moves to this spot, and boom, they're up again. Right. And we're just constantly chasing. If Congress could also enact, make it illegal to aid and abet the carrying out of this, and I think that's also what the NAB group has recommended. If we can get at those who are aiding and abetting, because there's a cabal that pulls this off, right? Mm-hmm. Well, you moved to my apartment over here, you moved to this space over here, and then you go to see the people, oh, we didn't know anything about this, you know. And so there is a totality of the package here. I mean, 200 enforcements, we have a task force working on it. We could use some additional authority so we could have some teeth.
I'm about out of time, so two things. One is, maybe this is a rhetorical question, but I'll ask it. There's been suggestions that the FCC has actually directed field offices to step down and back away from enforcement. Any truth in that?
I have heard that suggestion.
Right.
I have not.
So I'm going to put it right out here.
I have heard that suggestion. I have not seen that command.
And it did not come from you?
Did not come from me.
Could you provide me the language that you might suggest? Because I can appreciate, you know, don't bring me a problem without a solution. Can you bring me the language that we might put in
Great.
To some other legislation that would assist you on the pirate radio issue?
Thank you, sir.
It is an important issue for us in New York, and we just don't want to be the last thing on Friday afternoon at 4:59. Somebody said, I have 1 minute till I go home. Let me see what I can do on pirate
yes,
radio.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. I yield back.
Gentleman yields back. Chair now recognizes the gentleman from North Dakota, Mr. Kramer.
Thank the chairman and the ranking member once again for suffering long with me as you wait for the last questioner. And thanks to both of you as well. And thank you, Commissioner Pai, for referencing the letter that 114 of my closest friends and I sent to the chairman and to the FCC regarding standalone, and to both of you for addressing it so thoroughly today. And I might just hone in a little bit on some of the finer points regarding the timeline, because in the letter I received, Mr. Chairman, from you yesterday, you often referred to a lack of consensus. There seems to be some consensus. You've pledged that by the end of the year we'll solve this, but we need more consensus from stakeholders. As you both know, of course, the RLEC community presented a plan in 2013, modified somewhat over the last couple of years to meet moving targets. I might ask you, Commissioner Pai, you've offered up, I think your quote or from your plan was as simple amendments to existing rules as an outcome. And one thing I've noticed around here, and I've certainly noticed in regulatory bodies, having served on one, we can tend to complicate simple things. My goal is usually the opposite of that. Are there issues in the RLEC plan that prevent this from going forward or prevent us from utilizing that as the model? Or are there other issues that have caused this to take so long that you know of?
Thanks for the question, Congressman, and thank you also for your kind words about my proposal, which in turn is modeled on your letter. I think stepping back to 60,000 feet, I think the problem is basically this. There are a number of problems with the high-cost fund, A, B, C, D, E. Problem A, however, is standalone broadband service. And my position has been, consistent with your letter and a companion letter in the Senate, that let's adopt targeted changes to our rules to make sure that rate of return carriers aren't penalized for offering broadband as a standalone service. Now, that's not to say that problems B, C, D, E aren't important, but for the purposes of this issue, standalone broadband service, let's get that piece of it done and then turn to the other issues. Now, the issue with the rate of return carriers and the consensus, I appreciate the efforts of my colleagues to try to find that consensus, but nonetheless, number one, it's not necessary to resolve those issues to adopt a standalone broadband solution, and number two, if we end up waiting until a consensus emerges on those other issues, I fear we're not going to meet the deadline we set for ourselves and publicly for getting this done by the end of the year.
Chairman Wheeler, can we meet the end of the year deadline? Is there a reason we can't meet that, and are we attaching too many other things to the simple solution?
Those are the two right questions. I'm trying to do that. It is my goal to do it. I expect to do it. A couple of points here. In order to do that, you cannot be wedded to consensus. As you know from your previous term, at some point in time, you got to pull up and shoot.
Indeed.
Boy, am I trying to get consensus. But if you can't get everybody to agree, at some point in time, you got to put, and we will put forward a proposal on that in a timely basis in order to do things by the end of the year. Because at the root of this is that we've got to do better for rural consumers, period. And it's not just one simple fix. It is a broader set of fixes, because I am in violent agreement on the narrowband broadband issue, but it's not enough. And then we also have a responsibility to those people who are paying for this every month in their phone bills to make sure that the money is spent responsibly. And I hope we have consensus. I'm working for consensus, but if we can't have consensus, we need to have progress.
Well, there are other issues that FCC's taken up this year that I wish there would have been more consensus on. So I don't want consensus to mean 100%, as you might imagine. Shifting then just a little bit with my remaining time, we've spent some time talking about, of course, the auction. I was about to call it the voluntary auction. That's what it used to be called. I think it still is. It has the word voluntary is how it's often referred to, because of course it is in fact voluntary, both opting in and opting out. And as you know, the $1.75 billion that Congress has put in for the repacking fund is probably not going to be enough, considering that we're looking at what 1,100 maybe TV stations that are going to have to involuntarily move. How are we going to, is there a plan to deal with that shortfall that I can assure my rural North Dakota broadcasters that they won't have to bear all the costs? Maybe Commissioner Pye first and then Chairman with the remaining time.
Congressman, I have long suggested that we should treat the $1.75 billion relocation fund as a budget at the FCC and structure the auction in such a way as to minimize the possibility that we would exceed it and ultimately end up putting the onus on the broadcasters to pay up. The other issue that I've heard most recently in Nebraska from a group of broadcasters is that the 36 months is not necessarily as long as it might seem, that there's a shortage of people who are able to do the work, there's a shortage of the equipment that's necessary for the repacking to be done, and that the commission should be mindful of that as well as it progresses. So I share your concern, and I want to make sure that broadcasters, to the extent possible, are held harmless in terms of the necessary expenditures.
Chairman, do you want to speak over the red
light? I think Commissioner Pye has identified the key issue, and that is we do need to make sure that we have to live within a budget. We want to manage things within a budget. You gave us that number. We can't change that number, and we've got to come up with a program that will make it work.
Thank you both. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
And if you hang around, Mr. Kramer, we're going to do a second round. You could be, like, really quick on the shot clock here. We're now going to go to the gentleman from New Mexico, Mr. Lujan, for five.
Mr. Chairman, thank you so much for having us here today. Ranking Member Eshoo, it's an honor to be here with both of you. Chairman Wheeler, Commissioner Pye, thank you for joining us as well. I appreciate the testimony centered around rural access. As Commissioner Pye said, he's a rural guy. I'm a rural guy. I think Chairman Walden also represents a very rural district, as we talk about many parts of the country that need broadband access and affordability. And you've heard me say this many times, Chairman Wheeler, if we can have connectivity at 30,000 feet when we're flying across the United States in an airplane, there's no reason that we cannot have connectivity when we're on the ground, traveling all across America, not only in rural communities, tribal communities, and states like mine in New Mexico. With that being said, in New Mexico, for example, 77% of those living in rural communities and 89% living in tribal communities lack access to advanced broadband. Chairman Wheeler, as you say in your testimony, you've pursued an aggressive agenda at the FCC that includes reforming the E-Rate program, modernizing the Lifeline program, and establishing the Connect America Fund. Can you discuss what this agenda means for people who lack sufficient access to broadband and communication services, not just with build-out, but also with making it more affordable so people are able to take advantage once there's a build-out program?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Congressman. And I hope that we can do significantly better than is the speeds that are delivered in the air. And that's what we're doing. I have been in New Mexico multiple times, in tribal areas and other very remote areas in New Mexico, to personally visit and talk to the individuals involved. I remember a situation There was a fiber going down this side of the road, a fiber on an Indian reservation. And over here, about 100 yards away, was a high school. And up here was the library. And they couldn't get a connection from the fiber to the high school because it was cost prohibitive and the E-rate program wasn't paying for that. Now we pay for that. And that's in large part because of these kinds of specific examples that we've seen. We need to make sure this is the case. We also need to make sure that that low-income individuals who are unfortunately disproportionately represented on tribal areas have access to broadband support to connect them. And that is why we are not only overhauling, but changing the orientation of the Lifeline program to go to broadband.
And Chairman, we're in all these areas. I'm going to submit some other questions into the record to flesh these areas out. But you know, as we do this, I really appreciate the conversation that we've had today and the focus and seeing how we can grow the rural family as well and see how we get more attention there. The other place that I want to compliment both you and Commissioner Pai, Chairman Wheeler, and get your perspective is on modernizing the FCC. You've embarked on expanding electronic filing and distribution, decreasing backlogs, and improving responsiveness to consumers. Can you both tell me what you're doing to provide greater information to consumers, including improving transparency and accountability, standardizing forms, digitizing the process, including the submittal of documents?
Boy, am I glad you asked that question.
And you both support that effort? Yes, Commissioner Pai?
Yes.
On my first trip to our consumer operation in Gettysburg, I saw in the corner a humongous machine that that the staff proudly announced to me could take 17 different forms and put them into one envelope. And I said, well, why are we sending out 17 different forms? And they said, well, because that's the way we do it. So you contact the FCC on a robocall issue, and we will send you the form for robocall, as well as the form for loudness on commercials, as well as the form for every other kind of complaint we had. And I said, wait a minute, we can do
that. And then those forms are required to be sent back.
And the and I would talk to consumers, you know, who would say, what am I supposed to do with this? Which form am I supposed to use? So we now have totally updated it, put it on the web. We just won a prize for being one of the best government sites, consumer interface sites on the web. And most of all, we're then taking that information and putting it back into what should we be doing to help us focus on our priorities.
That's great. Mr. Chairman, you know, if there's other areas that we can work on in this space, I look forward to having those conversations. And if I'm able to, because of the length of the line, Mr. Chairman, look forward to the second round of questions.
Indeed. Thank you, Chairman. I think we can get there from here. Which we're going to start now, so thank you. I want to go back to this issue of LPTV and translators and maybe Commissioner Pai, Chairman Wheeler. There's all this talk now, the Commission, about setting aside an entire channel for unlicensed, and I support unlicensed. We've made a lot of unlicensed available. There's more to be done. But won't setting aside a whole channel for unlicensed contribute to the problem that we're hearing from translators and LPTV community?
Mr. Chairman, it will by definition, to the extent that a particular vacant channel is allocated solely for unlicensed, that means in the TV band, that means an LPTV station can't occupy it post-auction.
In Chairman reality, Wheeler. Probably not, because what we're talking about here are using TV white spaces and creating these kinds of additional applications for unlicensed. In those areas where the duplex gap is not sufficient. And that's going to be a handful of areas that I doubt will be any areas that are the typical LPTV rural kind of area.
So will you commit to LPTV and translators having priority then over unlicensed?
No, we're going to, so it was really clear.
In the TV band?
No, it was, I think that the mandate from this committee is clear. The mandate from this committee is that there is no priority given to LPTV. And the committee also said, however, that we need to be encouraging unlicensed. I don't think that it comes down to that kind of a solution, though, Mr. Chairman, with all due respect. I think that it is possible, and what we are just breaking our tails on, is to be able to accomplish both of these, and I think we'll be successful. Yeah.
I would say my recollection of the statute, which we together helped write here, was that unlicensed was never set aside as a priority to go create a nationwide ban. In fact, we had a lot of discussion about that very fact, that you don't go clear all this and then give it away to, in effect, some pretty major operators. Commissioner Pye?
And this is part of the reason why I've suggested that we adopt a technically sound solution to where to put broadcasters if we put them in the wireless band. If we put them in the uplink, then we avoid this entire issue altogether, whereas in the duplex gap, we not only impair unlicensed, which has to find a home, we impair wireless mics and downlink.
Should we just discuss that? I mean, this is a really good point that Commissioner Pye has raised, that there is serious concern on that. So first of all, let's remember what we're talking about here is how do we minimize the aggregate impact across the country? And that means that in a handful of markets, it's a percentage that is in single digits, okay, that there is an issue. He is proposing that you put it in the uplink. They put the interference in the uplink. What that does is knock out an entire base station.
Right.
So the impact is much far, much broader.
I think you've got disagreement with Commissioner Pye, but I'm going to have to move along here. My concern is there are a lot of remote. I hear from my colleagues all over the West. They're concerned these translators are going to go dark because they're going to get squished out, and if they get squished out because you created a whole band of unlicensed, that only adds to the problem. And there is a public interest obligation underpinning all of this at the commission to provide for. Now, I realize they're not class A. I realize they don't have all the rights and all that. I was a licensee of translators myself. I knew I could be pushed out. But through this, you've got some flexibility here to manage, and that's, I guess, what we're calling on you to use. I want to switch gears to go to the TCPA issue very quickly, because this issue of auto dialer has come up. And in your order, you adopted a pretty broad definition of an auto dialer, although you acknowledged, and I quote, there are outer limits to the capacity of equipment to be an auto dialer, and there must be more than a theoretical potential that the equipment could be modified to satisfy the auto dialer definition. Is my iPhone an auto dialer?
No, sir.
Then let me ask you this. There are at least three apps that we've found, Dial My Calls, CallBot Automated Calling, and VoxLean, that would turn my iPhone into an auto dialer.
So the issue that we were trying to deal with in this order was not the hardware, but the impact. Because the since Congress acted in 1991, the technology has changed. And what Congress's instructions to us were is no contact from auto dialers without permission.
But my question this, though, is if I push somebody's name, Chairman Wheeler's, I don't ever dial your number. I just push Chairman Wheeler, and it dials. To me, is that an auto dialer?
No, sir.
Okay, if I have a database of names that I want to reach out to, let's say voters, and I want to turn them out to vote, and I have a device that calls until somebody answers, and then I can take the call. Is that an auto dialer?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I no longer can do that. If I have a teletown hall in my office, which I do, and there's some company that does calls all those thousands of people in my district, are they now prohibited from doing this?
Unless the consumer has asked to get this. This is the statute is very explicit.
So teletown halls now by members of Congress, and most members do that, are now against?
I'm
asking you the question.
No, sir. That's
right. So those are prohibited, and your contention has always have been?
Yes, sir.
Wow. That's interesting. That would be news to a lot of people. Commissioner Pye?
Mr. Chairman, I think part of the reason why it is indisputable that a smartphone is an auto dialer under the FCC's new interpretation is that if you look at the statute, it says a capacity to randomly or sequentially dial a number. I explicitly said capacity means the actual capacity. This smartphone has in itself intrinsically the ability to do that. The majority rejected my argument and said, no, you could download an app. There are all kinds of other things you could do to effectively make the smartphone an auto dialer, even if it isn't intrinsically. And that's part of the reason why literally every communications device other than a rotary phone, I give the majority credit for accepting those, nonetheless is now subject to TCPA liability as an auto dialer. And that's not good for consumers. That's not good for providers. Not good for anybody other than trial lawyers.
Well, and we're hearing from others out there who are, there's this issue with the healthcare exchanges and whether or not insurance companies can follow up and like notify you that it's time for you to come in and have some tests done. I've been told that may be prohibited now. I mean, are you aware of that? Are you hearing those?
That's the first I've heard of it, but it doesn't surprise me because now we've seen from a number of different industries, they're just uncertain about what the rules of the road are.
Yeah.
Understand what we were doing, Mr. Chairman, was responding to a series of petitions. We did not issue a rule. People petitioned us and said, what is the rule? What does your...
Right, but you interpreted.
And if somebody wants to petition us on the kinds of things you talk about, we can deal with that.
Right.
On the healthcare issue one, we specifically had an exemption for being able to bank fraud, healthcare, things like this, and for government agencies.
And with changing technology, 40% of Americans no longer have a landline, right?
Right.
I know you spoke out and said basically pollsters could go the way of, blacksmiths, I guess.
Well, they have been, right?
Well, I guess my point is, so that industry, in effect, in terms of trying to do a random sample, is now put out of business, right? How do you do a random sample on a poll if you can't randomly sample and dial?
So I once sat down with Peter Hart to write a piece exactly on that insofar as wireless, because you can't have random, you can't get to the wireless numbers. Right. You don't know what they are. So that went by the board. The issue here is if you come to us and you say, the statute says, which it does, that the only folks who are allowed to be called are those who want to be called.
Got it.
And I'm supposed to be a strict constructionalist of the statute.
Well, we've seen some examples by the court where they would disagree with your interpretation of the statute on other issues,
violently and directly. And you are constantly encouraging me to be a strict constructionalist.
Yeah. Well, I think we're just trying to figure out the impact of your ruling as it relates to consumer. I've gone way beyond my time, but I'll now defer to my colleague from California, Ms. Eshoo.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Well, it's an important discussion. And I think that we need to talk about this some more because it's what went into the statute was like holding a mirror up to the country at that time.
In 91,
that's a long time ago. That's many, many moons ago when you think of generations of how many generations of technology changes have taken place. So whether someone wants to be a strict constructionist or whatever, I think that we have to have the elasticity to stay up with the times. Each one of us represents 750,000 people. Now, maybe we've got to reach out to every single one of them if we possibly can, but in my view, meeting with people relative to a telephone town hall meeting has been overwhelmingly embraced, not just accepted, but embraced by my constituents. Plus, it saves tons of money, and they get to just ask whatever they want. So these are, I don't think they'd be satisfied, well, this is what the statute says. I think they'd say, change whatever you have to change, but keep up with the changes that are taking place. So it's important. Since we're going into a second round, and maybe it's just the chairman and myself. No, that's the two others. Oh, good, Billy and Ben. I want to talk about your budget. The House appropriators have really screwed the FCC in plain English, in my view. And I don't think it's funny, I think it's serious. I mean, we had members asking questions today about travel budgets. I think that that whatever you do and however you do it, it would be interesting to see if it tracks along with how members of Congress are allowed to handle their MRA. I don't know, but it may be something for us to discuss. Now, the FY appropriations bill has $315 million in it. That reflects a cut of $25 million below the FY15 enacted level and $73 million below the request. Now, they also have placed in riders that relative to net neutrality and all of that. Now, what I'd like to ask you, Mr. Chairman, is have you had conversations with the appropriators? Is there anyone from the majority here that's been asked to lean in with the appropriators? I mean, we're constantly putting on the FCC and in oversight, all of these issues come up. I don't know who's going to do this work and follow up with every member's request about what they want. You wanted to close offices. Members said don't close them. We need them open. But, I mean, there are so many things that are reliant on dollars, and I'm not talking about having a load of extra dough. I'm talking about the agency being able to carry out its responsibilities. So what I'd like to know from you is, have you had conversations with the appropriators on the majority side? Have you had conversations with the majority side here to see what can be worked out with the budget? I don't know, these riders, the president is not going to sign something like that. And at the end of the day, I think that the appropriations process is so messed up around here because we don't have regular order, speaking of transparency and process and all of that, that we're going to end up with an omnibus bill. And I think that's what's going to happen. So compare and contrast what your present budget is, because an omnibus really doesn't really allow for that much more, and address for us any conversations or how you're following up with what the appropriators did to the budget of your agency.
Thank you, Congresswoman. We've had conversations with everybody who will listen and some who won't. And I mean that only in a flippant remark. I'm not saying people aren't listening. We've talked to this committee. We've talked to their committee. I was honored that the chairman came to the Appropriations Committee, which I think the first time that I've ever known that a chairman has actually come.
Second time. I was there last year.
Did I? Well, I missed you then.
I was right behind you and waving.
Okay. So that he's got a record now for being twice.
But that's not the point. I want to know about the money.
But yes, we have to live with the number that the Congress gives us. It's that simple.
Have you, in response to what the appropriators have done, and I don't know, Mr. Chairman, were you there to support the appropriators in cutting the budget or against it?
I was there to listen to the appropriators.
I see. Yeah. Oh, you didn't testify?
No.
Oh.
No, I was there to hear what they had to say.
I see. Have you come up with, you know what I'd like to ask you to do? Two things. What you will be able to do with a budget that is reduced by $25 million.
Yes, ma'am.
And also, and the top line things that you have to do. I mean, we've got to move forward with the auction, with the voluntary auction, and all the top line items. And also, if we have an omnibus bill, what that does. And I look forward to reviewing that. I think it should be sent to everyone on the committee. I would really like to see that because we're walking into something that I think the members of this subcommittee that have oversight responsibility are going to have to understand that we either have to curb our appetite for giving the FCC assignments that if they don't have the dollars to carry them out, then they don't have the dollars to carry them out. Something's going to go. something's going to go.
I will tell you one interesting thing. We are currently at the lowest number of full-time employees in modern history for the agency.
Thank you.
Thank you, gentlelady. Now go to the gentleman from Missouri, Mr. Long.
I was very impressed that I got to follow the chairman for the first time.
You hang around long enough.
I felt kind of like Sally Field. I thought, they really do like me. Then I looked around and no one else was here. So, Commissioner Pye, I've got a question for you. It's been reported that the chief of the Enforcement Bureau has acknowledged that many of his cases fall into the legal gray area, where companies might not even realize they're doing anything wrong. I know you've raised concerns about this. Can you kind of explain your concerns and what could be done to address them?
Thanks for the question, Congressman. I think, unfortunately, many of the FCC's more high-profile enforcement initiatives have betrayed that basic principle of due process, and that's not FCC law. That's going back to King John signing the Magna Carta 800 years ago this summer at Runnymede. And I think part of the reason why I've been so outspoken about it is that if private actors, from companies all the way to individuals, don't know what the rules of conduct are, then they have no reason to know that their conduct is violating what the FCC thinks should be the rule. And with respect to certain notices of apparent liability the agency has issued, it's almost more a quest for headlines first, and we'll figure out the law later, if at all. But that has it precisely backwards. To me, we should look at the facts. We should look at what the law is. If there's a gap in the law, let's change it to make sure that people are abiding by what we think is proper conduct. But we can't sanction somebody for violating a rule that they have no reason to know or don't know exists.
Okay, thank you. And Chairman Wheeler and Commissioner Pye, to the two of you, I'm curious about the Broadcasters Relocation Fund and how those monies are going to be spent. The fund's currently $1.75 billion, as you know, and obviously that fund was set up to pay for all of the relocation costs to the broadcasters who are required by the FCC to move to a new channel as part of the auction. After examining these issues for the last few years, have the FCC determined how many stations it is able to repack with that $1.75 billion fund?
It is a moving target depending upon the characteristics of who participates in the auction. Do you have to move an antenna? Do you have to build a taller antenna? How far do you have to move it?
Can you give me a ballpark on the number?
I can get back to you with one, sir. I don't have one on the top of my head. But what I tried to do is to develop a set of rules that can live inside of that, and so let me get you the number we use for denominator in that.
Okay, if I don't know. I appreciate it. And Commissioner Pye, same question to you.
I have heard estimates that it will cost somewhere north of $3 billion to relocate all broadcasters, and if that figure is correct, and we only have $1.75 billion in the relocation fund, then it necessarily follows that broadcasters will be out of pocket for that extra $1.25 billion. And that's something that I hope to avoid, and certainly I'm willing to work with you and the chairman and my colleagues to make sure that doesn't happen.
Well, do you have any estimate on the number that the $1.75 billion, that's the number I'm trying to get to, how many that would
cover? No, unfortunately, I don't, because as the chairman pointed out quite eloquently, that there are a lot of moving parts to this, and every broadcaster is unique.
Okay, because I've heard some figures, and I have difficulty believing that $1.75 billion will cover the estimated number that they're talking about. So if both of you could get back to me on that, I would appreciate it. And I'm going to yield back with a minute 37 to go.
Gentleman yields back. Chair recognizes gentleman from New Mexico, Mr. Lujan.
Thank you, Chairman Walden. And I'd like to associate myself with the questions that both Ranking Member Eshoo and Chairman Walden were asking pertaining to what appears now to be our inability to reach out to the American people to be able to get feedback from them. Chairman Wheeler, as we talk about these telephone town halls, when I traveled the 3rd Congressional District of New Mexico, especially in rural communities, one of the things that I hear from members of the community I represent, we sometimes have to travel 3 or 4 hours just to get to town centers, not even city centers, is how much they appreciate being able to weigh in. So if the rule requires them to opt into this program, how would we reach out to 700,000-800,000 constituents for them to opt in? We can't send them an email because based on a 2015 press release coming from the FCC,
only 52 or 48% of those making less than $25,000 have broadband service at home. And so if we can't reach out to them to opt in, do I send them a letter, which is what the FCC is working against? You don't want to be sending letters and forms out to opt in, and then you'd have to say check a box, yes or no, and then you get the letter back in. I certainly hope that we can look at this to see how we can address this. And I know it's something that I've visited with Chairman Walden and with Ranking Member Eshoo, with both the majority and minority staffs on this. So look forward to working with you on that as well. With that being said, just some additional questions about broadband penetration. There's been a little bit of conversation today about broadband. And Chairman Pai, do you see broadband penetration or accessibility in rural parts of the country to broadband as a necessity or a luxury?
Well, Congressman, thanks for the question. As I said in response to Congresswoman Eshoo earlier, my goal has been always to make sure that any American anywhere, whether it's on a tribe in New Mexico or somewhere in my home state of Kansas, anyone who wants digital opportunity in terms of a broadband connection should be able to get it. And that's why I've laid out proposals on rural broadband, on E-rate, on wireless infrastructure, on 5 gigahertz spectrum, to make sure that we have a bunch of competitors out there all competing to provide every American with that opportunity. And you know, as far as the semantic classification of it, that's something that I'll leave to wiser minds than myself. But my focus is on Section 1.
With the semantics associated with the difference between necessity and luxury, how would you characterize the importance of accessibility to broadband in rural parts of the country?
Oh, I think it's absolutely critical. And one of the things I've enjoyed in this job is having a chance to travel to small towns from Diller, Nebraska to Fort Yukon, Alaska, to be able to see how people have used broadband to get opportunities they otherwise wouldn't have. I'm sure this is the case in your district, but I've seen it in a lot of rural districts that if people don't get that high-speed connection, they'll move somewhere else. They'll move to another state or a bigger city to get it. And that's unfortunate because I think there are a lot of ideas in rural America that are probably withering on the vine for lack of that broadband connection. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I'm passionate about, and I'd be more than happy to work with you.
I appreciate that. Yeah. Well, I would characterize it as a necessity, not a luxury. I really appreciate you considering it or characterizing it as absolutely critical. I would agree with that assessment as well. With that, Commissioner Pai, as well, as we look to the Lifeline program as well, and in the testimony that, or your dissent to the 2015 order, in it there were some concerns associated with the cost to the program to date. And in your dissent, you did recognize that there have been some reforms that we look back to 2012. Understanding that in 2005, 2008, we saw a transformation of Lifeline that went from rotary landline phones to being able to go into mobile phones and now into smartphone apparatus. Since then, in 2012, the commission came forward with a unanimous opinion, which resulted in a reduction of $214 million in savings in 2012, with a substantial projection going into 2014. I'm trying to still get the numbers on what those realized savings were as well. But in your dissent, you also listed a concern where there were providers that were signing people up fraudulently, which we need to crack down on, and we share that concern. But in the 2015 order that you dissented, there was a reform in there that did state that we would, that the FCC would remove the ability for providers to sign people up for Lifeline for verification. Mm-hmm. Is that something that, with that principle, is that something that you agree with? And were there other areas that you disagreed with in the order? But is that something that you could agree with and we could work on together?
Oh, I would love to work with you on that. And I do think that verification is a critical issue. I think one of the problems that I cited in my dissent is the case that is the fact that fly-by-night operators like Icon Telecom in Oklahoma, they just created so-called Lifeline customers out of whole cloth, got a lot of money for doing it, and the CEO ended up pocketing $20 million. And spent it on his own private expenses. And that's something we need to weed out. We need more enforcement action. We need to reform the rules. And we need to have that conversation about how to have a fiscally responsible program.
And so I appreciate the reforms the commission's put in place. The last question I have is $1.6 billion the right cap? As you and I share a concern with broadband availability in communities. But I would hope that we both would agree that it's not just accessibility from an infrastructure perspective to broadband, it's also an affordability question in many rural parts of the country. What's the right number for a cap, and should it be arbitrary or should it be based on data?
I do believe it should be fact-based, and that's part of the reason why I suggested a cap or a budget of $1.6 billion, because the program was at $800 million in 2009. It's now at $1.6, and it's the only one of the Universal Service Fund programs that isn't capped. And so what I suggested was, look, we need to have a balance here. We need to make sure that we target the people who are offline in the Lifeline program. We also have to make sure that we're responsible stewards of the consumers' tax dollars. After all, this is paid for by consumers. And 1.6 seemed to me to be a good conversation, a good starting point to have.
But 1.6 is based on last year's numbers. There's no, the only data associated there is that's what the number ramped up. But year to year, that number changes. Understanding that the inflation from 2008 to 2012 was because the reforms weren't necessarily in place that helped us back that number down with the reforms in 2012 and the recent actions by the FCC in 2015. So, Mr. Chairman, this is an area maybe where we can work on together as well, but I look forward to having more conversations in this space as well. Thank you for the time, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We appreciate your participation and that of our witnesses. And speaking of outdated data, just in closing, the quadrennial review I referenced in my opening statement is now, I think the last one we got is probably 8 years old. So I hope the commission will deal with the quadrennial ownership report on a basis as required by statute. AM modernization is still something high on a number of our priorities. And on the DSTAC issue, we ask in Stellar that the commission deal with the downloadable security issues, and it appears that committee was given direction to work on disaggregation of data on video stream. So, again, we're after the downloadable security issue. I have one letter to put in the record from Care Payment without objection, and I think you heard, Mr. Chairman, bipartisan concerns here on TCPA. We realize you're implementing the law. It appears a law that was created back in 91 when you got charged for incoming phone calls. Nobody's talking about robocalls here for cell phones, and none of us want that, but I think there's an issue here where we need to take a look at that law. So with that, thank you for your diligence and your patience, and with that, subcommittee stands adjourned.
All right, here we go.
Yeah.
See you later.
Yeah.
All right.
Sounds good.
Good job, Mr. Chairman. Always.
Hello, Jerry.
Always patient.
How are you?